I believe that we are in fact live. So welcome everybody to the RPG Blender, where we give lesser played games and forgotten settings the roll of the dice they deserve. I'm your host, Game Master George, and we are here to finally embark on this Kids on Brooms adventure. Joining me today are Kate. Hello, Kate. Welcome.
Hello.
The new mama. Go ahead and introduce yourself. And thank you, Danielle, for that Prime subscription. Walrus, oh boy.
Oh, Walrus. Yes, that is me. I am Kate, aka Noob Mama. And it is lovely to be back. I'm so excited to actually start this time. I've really been looking forward to it. I mean that.
Yep, and I didn't leave you muted at the beginning of this stream, so we're already ahead of the game.
You're learning. Mm. We're doing great.
All right, and next up we have Rich, Dr. Mr. Freckles.
What's going on, everybody? That's it.
Thank you, Rich. Thank you for that content.
Yes!
Nice.
Yes!
Oh, boy. No elf ear headphones for Kate.
Okay, clearly I have to take a second to explain to everybody that those earphones hurt my ears. And they're stinky, cheap earphones. That's it. I'm just, whatever.
You guys wouldn't want Noob Mama to feel pain, would you?
Yeah, would you?
Have you seen what they do?
Actually,
to
they're going
to,
yeah, you know what? They're going to say, yeah, don't even.
I mean, shoot, I throw in some of those rewards.
They're savages. Yeah, you did.
Can we put their character names on their cards? Those are actually animated backgrounds, so I can't just quickly edit that, but I will be throwing their character names up there, assuming I can figure it out. Anyway, last up is Craig, Do and Die Gaming.
Howdy, howdy, everybody. Thanks for joining us. We've completely forgotten what's going on, so it'll be as fresh for you as it is for us.
All right, let me go ahead and quickly turn off that one thing, but while I'm doing that, you guys have work to do.
Oh, come on, George. We had a whole last session of doing work.
You thought that you were done here. But the truth is that there is one thing left for you to establish with this school. And that is, each one of you has heard some kind of rumor about something going on in the school. None of you know what story I've written, and what rumor you come up with might play into it or might change the story that I've written for your adventure here.
No,
so each one of you now needs to come up with some rumor, which may or may not be true. I'm guessing we should not start with Craig, given the face he is currently making.
I think we should start with Rich.
That's always a safe bet, yeah.
We're just always throwing Rich down the rabbit hole. Why don't we give him a day off?
Because
why don't we
it'll take a long time. It'll give us time to think. And
you hear that, Rich?
Something really good.
I already know what it is. Like, I already did
see?
It.
Well, see? I mean,
oh, my God.
There we go.
Okay.
Are you ready? Do you want me to go? Or?
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, so Mrs. Stabitha, the art teacher, there's a rumor that she's actually married to Mr. Stabitha, the math teacher.
Are you for real right now?
We don't know, but we're pretty sure.
Did you say Stabitha?
Yeah.
Bring it in the heavy rumors. Heavy rumors. There might be a marriage. We don't know.
All right. And now that you've given your...
This is kind of dumb stuff that kids talk about, though.
That's fair.
Yeah,
that's
I guess
fair.
That's fair.
Well, now that you've given your your rumor, what is your character's name? Introduce yourself. And yes, a rose, don't worry. I've seen that baby check. We're going to get it in there soon. All right, Rich, introduce yourself.
My name is Desmond Dillian. I am an all-star at the game... the Shifting Hunt. I'm going to try and go pro, and I'm going to try and be the youngest person to go pro with my great teammate, Barnabas. And, hopefully Amelia will, make sure that I'm not flunking out of school. That'd be nice. Also, are the Stabathas married? Are they allowed to kiss in school? I'm pretty sure that's illegal.
Oh, shoot. Oh, Rich. That is very different from what I've come to expect from you, Rich, but okay. All right. Who would like to go next?
I think Kate looks really ready.
What are you doing?
She's just drinking her drink so peacefully.
Don't disturb my peace.
Okay. The people are waiting.
Sure, yeah, I'll go.
I warned you I was going to be throwing something at you.
Yeah, you sure did.
We felt like death, like things you don't
throw. Yeah, I was hoping it was something more like just roll dice at it. But okay, sure. Another rumor. It's a rumor about our school, right? Something about our school. Okay. So, another rumor is that there were three tenured professors at our school who are the only professors who stayed following the spirit manifestation disaster. There is questions about their involvement in the incident and whether or not they had purposeful agenda behind it, or if they were genuinely trying to stop the disastrous potential result that occurred. Do you want names?
Yes.
I was going to say, you know the answer to that question.
I do. I sure do.
You got Mr. and Mrs. Stabatha.
Yes. So, obviously, the Stabathas. first professor is Professor Whittleton.
Okay.
Leo Whittleton. The second professor is Professor Margaret Thatch. What's so funny over there? That's a real name. That's a genuine name.
Sorry.
That's her birth name. Kate.
Okay.
And the last one is Professor Stu Bates.
Oh, yeah.
Nice.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. And why don't you go ahead and introduce yourself?
Yes, I am. What am I? All right. I'm Barnabas William Peck, but my friends call me Barney.
Okay, succinct. All right, Kate, that's all the time you're getting.
Okay. So there is a particular rumor going around that we established that there's like woods nearby, right?
But now they're gonna be there.
Well, guess what? There are woods nearby.
Oh,
nice.
And there is a rumor that deep within those woods, there is a pond that's perfectly circular, and the surface is as still and as glass. You know, it has this like sheen to it, and the kids are saying that if you go out into the forest and you look at it, only the bravest people go and look at the pond and look at their own reflection, because there's a rumor that the pond can steal your face. So a lot of kids have been starting to dare each other to go do it, and it's like, you know, bragging rights if you actually go and prove that you did it.
Okay. So face stealing mirror lake.
I was gonna say, it just sounds like a mirror. It doesn't even sound like a pond. It sounds like a ground mirror.
I just want to point out, we already had an obelisk and a ley line, and you just added a lake that steals faces.
That's why I felt like just a normal teenage rumor was good. I was like, I've done enough to hurt us. I don't want to.
I did like the opposite of what you did, Rich. Okay.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, that's fair.
Normally, it's the other way around.
Double down. Yeah, not for nothing. We had a whole list of ridiculous things, and you just decided to go back to the list?
I mean, at other wizard schools, they have trees that beat you to death. So, I mean, this is, I mean, you don't obviously have to be a child-friendly wizard school.
She added a forest, so we probably have the tree that beats you to death as well.
Somewhere in there.
Yeah, come on.
All right. Called. And then go ahead and introduce yourself.
My name is Amelia Gershwin Prinsky. I don't come from much, but I study very hard and hope to be an accomplished witch one day.
Is that Amelia or Emilia?
Amelia, with an A.
Let me fix that.
George.
Throws my whole lot into...
Oh, no.
So many riddles.
Spell Amelia. I'm blanking on the spelling of the word Amelia.
A-M-E-L-I-A.
Great. Okay. There we go. All right.
And I just want everyone to know that there are some people in the chat that wanted me to ship the boys instead of... Go. Whoa.
Sorry about that.
Whoa.
Cool.
That is really cool.
Transition.
Star wipe.
I'm sorry, Beck. Yep. Bros. They're disappointed now.
It's not that easy, gang. You're going to have to stick around if you want to see where these boys go.
All right.
All the way to pro.
Then with that, let's get this baby cam in here to appease. Oh,
he was moving earlier, chewing on his hands, guys.
Yeah.
Oh, Beck missed Kate's rumor. Nah. Okay. Here we go.
Well,
everybody ready?
I'm sure it won't come up again.
Okay. You find yourselves... And another day at your great school of Pigazit. You have once again defended yourselves from the mocking laughter of your rival schools that you correspond with via the W mail. But that's fine. They don't understand the great tradition you have at your school. The storied tradition of magical excellence, buoyed by the great events that have occurred here. The formation of Petrified Pete, the existence of the ley line, the origin of magic, and some of the most unique classes, like mortal economics, or the possibly dark art of spirit manifestation. Each of you are, of course, students here. And perhaps one day you will graduate and make your way into the wider wizarding world and do great things. But perhaps you won't be waiting until then. But right now you find yourselves at lunch. Where do each of you eat in the grand dining hall? And with whom?
Do we have, like, households?
I mean...
You did not establish it, but this is your chance to. You see, the thing about this system, this in the Kids on Bikes, Kids on Brooms, Teens in Space series, the GM is much more of a facilitator. The world and everything that's going on is being created by you. So I have created some things, but you have created the majority of this world. And as we go, if you introduce narrative elements... They will exist unless there's some very good reason for them not to.
Well, I assume that we're in a house then. We're definitely in a house, right? We're a wizard school. We've got to have houses.
Okay. What is the name of your house?
Oh, gosh.
Well.
See what she did?
You all thought the world building was done.
Ours is obviously...
Oh, hang on. This is yours. They haven't established if they're a part of your house yet.
Oh, that's a good point. All right. Well, Barnabas is a part of God, why did I do this to myself?
Yeah,
why did you do this to us?
He's a part of Lamb Spew. The house Lamb Spew.
Oh, that's so ooh.
Okay. The house lamb spew from Pigazit. All right.
Yeah, you got it.
Yeah, of the great ancient wizard. Hargrim the Wonderful.
Yeah. Man, we got to start having the chat use this name generator thing so that you guys don't have
please
to come up with these
yeah,
names.
Then
or at least
have
when Craig
to do what
has
you
to
say.
Come up with
please,
a name.
Please, everyone.
hey, I got more. I got more coming, all right?
All right, so you have established your House of Lamb Spew.
Look, you can open the door. I'm going to walk right through, okay? I'm just saying.
You're going to do something.
Lamb Spew, one of the lower represented houses within the school. As it has a somewhat lacking reputation of its members being a bit uncouth. Anyway, you find yourself at lunch, eating with the members of your household?
Yeah, I'm probably around my fellows, because it's like a
comfort house.
Oh, come on, guys!
You what? Did this to yourself.
Well, that's me.
Well, that's fine. That's fine. I'm eating with my fellow house members. So, what are you two doing?
It was coming, eventually. I am sitting with a couple people from my house, but we're all just sort of like. Like, I'm reading and eating at the same time. I have, like, a pile of books. And the house that I am part of is called a name that goes by something like the...
could have just been a part of Lamb Spew, just saying.
I don't want to be in Lamb Spew. the owl quills.
Okay.
I love it.
The owl quills. Amelia Gershwin eating with her members of the Owl Quill House. Slightly more respected than Lamb Spew. They have a bookish reputation, of course, as is evident in Amelia herself. However, she takes it to an extreme at times. Oh. Something that perhaps even her fellow Quillians look down on.
Okay, George. That felt hurtful and unnecessary.
You named yourself.
Mm-hmm.
And Desmond, with your
I eat in the middle of the cafeteria with a smattering of a bunch of people from all the houses because I get along with most people and, you know, I'm kind of a big deal. So, yeah.
Right, because you are the sports star of this school.
Even though Barnabas actually does have a bit more clout than me, for some reason he likes to eat among the lamb spews. Sometimes I feel like he kind of just, like, he doesn't want to rise above them, but it's all right.
And what house are you in?
I am part of House Phasmic Chaos. They are actually named after the progenitor of the Spire, Patronic Pezzarel, which is why we call him Petrified Pete, because it's just way easier than calling him, you know. Patronic.
We want to repeat that? The founder is Petrified Pete, the one that tried to absorb
that is what
magic?
It is named off of, yes. The house is named off of that. But generally speaking, the people of this house are people who tend to be a bit more, for lack of a better word, reckless. The brightest candles, but the ones who burn out the fastest. It is just the nature. But pushing magic is something that is part of magic. And so it is kind of just accepted that the kids that are going to be reckless, it's easier to kind of put them all in one spot, keep an eye on them, and see what comes of it. You're going to get a few diamonds, and you're going to get a lot of burnt up lumps of coal.
Okay. So, the phasmic somethings? Phasmic chaos.
This works so well. All of these names work so well together.
Hey, look, Lamb Spew was a simple name, all right? The simple name.
Lamb Spew is beginning to rise in the opinions of the other houses. But anyway, we have the Phasmic Chaos. The house that is generally left to do its own thing, because when you involve yourself in the workings of the Phasmic Chaos, you are asking to be turned into a toad against your will. Not on purpose, of course, merely as a byproduct of whatever new strange technique they are engaging in.
We gave that one kid immortality, and he's been 12 for 100 years, so...
Doesn't sound like a good
and
thing.
And immortality is now a thing. Okay. And you want to introduce yourself. You did that already. That's fine. I'm sorry. I'm losing my mind with
we're
this
unraveling.
Stuff.
We're unraveling.
I am unraveling. You are watching my brain disintegrate here.
That's content.
Oh, jeez. Yes. So, each of you is engaging in your lunchtime activities with your own separate groups. So, I would like each of you to roll me a luck roll. This is simply pure luck. This is not a stat, as far as I'm aware. This is simply pick one of your stats and then roll that die. This is, and the stat that you choose will impact the results of the roll.
Wait, why wouldn't I just choose my best one?
Well, your best stat is not necessarily your biggest one. Remember, using that d20, yes, it has the highest potential for a high number, but it has the widest range. Whereas using a smaller one has a greater chance of getting that maximum value, which lets you roll again.
Oh, shoot. Exploding dice.
Yes, exploding dice. So when you roll that d4, you're only getting a 1 through 4 unless you get that 1 in 4 chance of getting a 4.
How dare you?
Oh, my God. So, loaded dice.
I was going to, you know, and I have to be fair. I had the d20 in my hand to do brains. Because I'm not going to be like, oh, a 7, then I'm going to do my d8. I don't want to be like that.
Okay. So, he gets a 7. We know who the target for most of these redemptions are going to be.
Of course.
Rich, Craig, Desmond, and Barnabas.
I got an 11.
I got a 4.
Okay. And what stat did you choose, Desmond?
I chose grit, because it's a die 6. I felt good about that, and it exploded once, and then once.
Okay. You chose your grit, your physical determination. And as you are stomaching the food around you, do you have a healthy appetite?
Yeah, I imagine that polymorphing eats up a lot of calories, so I probably eat just a ton.
Mm-hmm. So the people around you are giving you the little scraps left over, seeing if you'll eat it, you know, the stupid stuff that teenagers do.
I put orange juice on these fries, and I'm like, you're an idiot. I like both those things.
I'll go to the same place.
And eventually, one of them begins to be a little bit questionable to you. And as you are reeling from the effects of the orange juice soaked quail featherlings. I don't know what that is, but there you go. Quail featherlings. You overhear something. You hear from a table nearby someone talking about Professor
Stabatha.
Melinda Cosgrove, the teacher of mortal economics. They're saying that she's had some kind of breakthrough in tax theory, that she's been quiet about it and has been skipping classes, or at least cutting them short, and spending far more time within her office.
Well, that sounds cool.
The bell rings, signaling the end of lunch.
I am gonna go, I'm gonna run up, and I'm gonna purposely, like, bump into, Amelia.
Okay.
I'm going to say, walk much? but I say it like that because I'm not good at bullying, so that's why she thinks we're friends.
Just kind of smile and nod. I say, I've heard that one already.
I think about turning my hands into tentacle fingers, but realize that that would also be redundant and don't.
Barnabas sneezes
through the crowd and goes, good one, good one! As he's catching on the coattails of whatever's going on.
Actually, good. Then I don't have to look for you. I go, hey, guys, I heard something.
Ooh.
Oh, I love hearing things.
Have you guys heard anything about the Stabathist?
What, they do professors? Besides that they just teach? Yeah. Yeah, they're teachers, right?
All right. I just wanted to check up on that. Anyway, also, the human economics professor thinks she might be getting a little too into the human world.
What do you mean?
I don't know. Apparently she's cutting her classes short and stuff and might have... Sorry, I was thinking about a really cool transformation. Anyway, that she might have found some sort of like a new tax code or something like that, or new like way to like do mortal taxes or something. But you know, that's more of your thing, Amelia. I don't really know. I think she's getting sucked into the mortal world and is gonna, you know.
So, do any of you take mortal economics?
Yes,
I probably do.
Desmond. Do you take mortal economics?
Chat, do I take mortal economics? I feel like things that have to do with not transforming myself or things I would not be super into doing. But I want to let you guys decide whether or not I take mortal economics.
All right. First response. Yeah. Oh, nope.
Nah.
Perfect.
Yeah, that's fair. Jersey has spoken.
Which is also probably why I am not super... I don't know anything about this lady, so I'm like... I think mortal economics is about living among mortals, like camping.
I guess she's been cutting them short. What would be the goal there? You know?
I guess it all depends on what she's doing, right?
Mm-hmm. Or... it could mean that she's about to change her lesson plans if everything's about to change, and we could get those lesson plans and sell them to the other kids.
But that's just terrible. Why?
Or you could study them and get better grades. You could just read them and get better grades.
I don't need to read them to get better grades because I already get good grades because I just study.
But Amelia, you can't study this because nobody else knows in that class. I mean, it's mortal economics. I mean, it's really been legacied in. Pig's eat. Nobody really cares about mortal economics.
Okay, yeah.
It's a coasting grade.
It's
mostly a failing coasting grade.
Okay, mm-hmm. I'm glad I didn't take it again.
But I do think it would be worth getting my hands on those. Making sure that she's just on the up and up, right?
Mm-hmm.
No. We're talking about stealing lesson plans from a professor.
No, I said that's something we could do.
Yeah, but we're not going to do that.
Mm-hmm.
We're just gonna take a look and make sure that she's still being a good professor because she's not doing her job right, Amelia. I mean, she's cutting classes short.
Well, that's.
I mean, that's got to mean something, right? Is that negligence? I think it's negligence.
What is it? It's wizard code number 39.
Oh yeah.
A wizard keeps a keen eye for the safety of you and I. Yeah.
Is that okay?
So we have to make sure that we're keeping a keen eye on each other to make sure that we're not going crazy or doing things we're not supposed to be doing. Getting too deep into mortal stuff might be one of those things. I've never heard of that happening before, but the point is we should know. Also, we're already in front of the door. I've been walking you guys to, so no reason not to go now.
Wow, you're really good.
I guess that all makes sense. Sure. I look into the classroom. Is it empty?
The classroom, well, no, the classroom is not empty. There is a class filing into it, the mortal economics class of this period. Are either
ever
of you
her office.
In this period? Oh, you went to her office?
Oh,
or
sorry,
her class?
Yeah, sure.
No, I said however her office, and I look across the hall.
Okay. Oh, yeah. Her office, you cannot tell if her office is empty because the office is closed.
I go and open the door.
The door is locked.
Dag.
Why don't you just use the unlocking spell?
Well, now that's...
That is practicing.
Practicing education, right, Amelia? It's like proper practice.
That just feels like breaking into a teacher's.
How much space is there on the cracks of the door?
Not enough for many animals to fit through.
Vermin, many animals.
Like insects might be able to fit through.
But could like an octopus?
No.
Have you seen the kind of
I have seen the kinds of things octopuses can get into. No, it could not fit through.
All right. That makes sense. It is a magical school. They would probably be ready for something like that. It's fine.
Yeah, that's true.
Okay. So
we should go to class, and then I should steal the key from the professor.
Wait, are we just not going to... You know what? And pull out my wand.
No!
I'm just going to practice real quick. And I just... And try and unlock it. I don't know. I think that's how this works.
So, the way that magic works is you will describe what you are trying to do. And you will pick a stat that is... you know, going to be appropriate to the action that you are trying to accomplish. You will then roll that die plus an extra d4 and do it against a target number.
Okay, cool. Yeah.
So trying to open a door. What method are you trying to do to open that door? Are you trying to unlock it sneakily? Are you trying to bash it down?
I think because most of the locks are probably pretty standardized at our school, so I understand the gist of them. So I'm really just focusing on that mechanism and just trying to just unlock it.
Okay, well.
Well, my man!
That is actually time to unlock it, blast the door with a fireball. That's not inaccurate, as this is a system of grades of success. So The more you pass the threshold by, the larger and stronger the effect that you are going to get. And let's see, this is a natural effect, something that could happen naturally, so that gives it a 1. It is a tiny effect because it is a book or smaller, so that brings it to 2. It is an instantaneous thing, which has a modifier of 0. Have you done this before?
Yes.
Would you say that you have cast it a few times, or you've done it many times?
Probably I've done it a decent amount of times. I'm down to be a little repscallion. So
I could see that.
I don't think I'm doing a lot of it, but...
So that increases the difficulty by 1, bringing it to a total difficulty of 3.
I think I met that.
For which you have rolled a 40 because of Walrusi. Now, normally, that redemption would require it to be a possible number to roll. However, since you have exploding dice, any number is possible.
That's true.
Oh, no.
Okay. You take... So, you, as the...
God.
Creator of the effect, get to narrate what happens because you were successful.
Okay.
Bearing in mind the threshold of success that you have, which is roughly a magnitude of
13.
Okay. Yeah, that's good. Cool. Yeah, so So Barney pulls out his wand from his sleeve and flicks it around and he hits it and we hear a click, and then we hear click, 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 as all of the locks within like a 20-foot radius also just triggered and unlocked simultaneously.
20-foot radius?
I don't know, 50-foot radius?
I was going to say this wing of the school, but...
Oh, okay, yeah. Then this
oh, my
okay,
God,
yeah.
Yes.
As this wing of the school, everything is just... click, 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 click. Just unlocked.
Desmond pats Barnabas on the shoulder and goes, great, now they have no idea who where it's coming from.
Amelia looks horrified. Just,
yeah, that's what I meant to do. Tucks it back into his sleeve.
Okay. So, the door is now open. The door is now unlocked.
I absolutely open that door.
Okay.
Don't worry, Amelia. We're just checking. We're not doing anything wrong. We're just making sure the professor's up to no, you know, no mischievous dealings. And I start...
Okay, I quickly run in after just to not be inconspicuous. Although, oh, I am a conspicuous person. I linger a little too long outside the doorway, nervously looking around before I go back in, before I follow.
Okay. So, you go into her office. Have any of you been in her office before?
Yeah.
Yeah, probably. For different reasons.
All right. You've been in the office before, and you are familiar with her fairly messy office. There are many books lying around. The walls are just papered with equations, quadratic formulas, things moving into dimensions of math that are usually reserved for higher levels of calculus. And you notice, amongst it all, that there is a fairly large series of these formulas between which she has poked pins into numbers and then driven string between them, almost like a conspiracy theorist's map of pictures.
What are those numbers?
What are those numbers? There are there is the number 5, there is the number 7, there is the letter A in one of the equations. There is the number 6. There are actually 3 7s, as well as a few X's, because X's are a very common part of an equation. And then one of them is actually on the division sign.
Okay. Oh. I thought that was going to be important, but you clearly made that up.
So. Stop it. Insane dribble.
Can I, like, roll a brains to just maybe try and understand what's happening here?
Absolutely.
Like, study the equations.
Absolutely.
Okay.
So this is something where you are not under any kind of duress.
Okay.
This would be a planned act. Well, actually, that's not true. Do you consider yourself under duress? Because you are in the teacher's office.
Yes. Okay. A little bit, because I'm curious, but I'm like, who should be here? Okay. You know.
Then in that case, it is a snap decision, which means that other people cannot spend adversity to increase your role. You can spend it for your own, of course.
Okay.
But you also cannot take the average. So whatever you roll is what you get.
Okay.
So what is your brains die?
So I'm rolling a d20.
Mm-hmm.
And I rolled a 15.
Okay. And I believe you have some brains modifiers, probably.
From
your wand, you probably have I think you took a brains modifier, right?
Actually, no, because remember Oh, wait a minute. Hold on. I thought I wrote it down somewhere. hang on.
Oh.
That's right. I didn't take two brains things.
Correct.
Just give me a second.
while Amelia is
like studying
into the formulaic wall, Barnabas sort of saddles over to Desmond and goes, "So, where do you think the notes would be? Where do you think? What are we looking for?"
Well, we're looking for something that nobody would think to look for. Okay, so if I was looking for something nobody would think to look for, does the symbol make any kind of symbol? Is it like a circle or anything like that?
No.
Like the way
at least not at least not an obvious symbol. It's a whole like bunch of different strings just crisscrossing. So there's probably some kind of pattern in there, but it's not like it's an obvious shape.
I'm not a brains guy, so I'd look at it and be like, not a circle. All right.
I'll check her desk. And goes over to her desk and starts going through all of her shit. No.
I'm looking around for things that are, like, less dusty. So this place is, like, covered with books and stuff like that. So I'm looking for, like, a well-used area.
Okay. So both of you can give me your brains rolls.
All right, the brain squad.
Yeah, this is where we shine. You know, I was just thinking, I need more brains rolls.
Die for.
That's... Okay, so I got a +1. Sorry.
So you have a 16. Okay.
Cool.
That's weird.
So as you're looking at it, there's not any kind of real pattern to the numbers. The equations don't seem to connect at all. However, as you're staring at it, the idea that he had of looking at shapes begins to fill your mind. And as you look at the crisscrossing of the threads, you can see it almost appears to be a blueprint of this very office. With the way that things crisscross, you can almost begin to see the corners, the little pieces of furniture at the edges. And where they all cross at the center appears to be a certain bookshelf.
I am going to go examine that bookshelf.
Okay. Desmond and Barnabas, what did you roll?
I rolled a one.
Okay, and Desmond?
I exploded three times on my die four.
Jesus.
And got a fudge in 17. I'm sorry, 15. I did that math wrong.
Jeez.
It was 4, 4, 4, 3.
And people should just, you know, always make steal Rich's rolls because he's always going to explode to oblivion.
With the die four, I've had it in other games where it's the king of exploding.
Yep. All right, so Barnabas, you get one adversity token. You can spend these to because you failed your roll.
Ha ha, you fell for my trap. I'm easygoing, so I get two adversity tokens.
Ah.
Nice.
So what was your total, Desmond? 11?
15.
15. 15.
3, or 4, 4, 4, 3.
Okay. Wow.
Also, if the record can show, Barnabas, as soon as he starts going through the desk, stops looking for anything important and starts pulling pieces of fruit out of his bag and putting it in drawers, in like tucked away in like the back corners and stuff.
Worst.
Yeah. So that eventually there will be like rotted fruit in there, and she'll be like, "What smells it here?" And then she'll be like, "Oh, rotted fruit!" And then.
Nice.
Go back to her.
Poor Melinda.
Oh my gosh.
She knew what she did.
Rich, your background is so dark that when you lean to the side, it looks like your camera died. Anyway. Desmond.
I brought my die 4.
You beautiful die 4. Desmond, you find, not in the desk, but off to the side, you find a book that has very little dust on it. Most of the stuff in this room does not have much dust. Because it's being actively used for her research. However, this book has absolutely zero dust on it and is not worn at all, almost as if it's never been opened, never been read. Meanwhile, Amelia, you go over to that bookshelf.
Yeah, and I just start, and I will say out loud, as I'm kind of like, you know, tracing along the books and just seeing if anything sort of sticks out as I go, and I just say, I think there's something about this bookshelf that's important.
Okay.
Yeah, there's something about this desk too.
I look over.
I throw the book onto the desk and I say, "Nerd alert!" But that's it.
Ooh.
All right, Amelia, you're going over that bookshelf, and most of the books on it are pretty rudimentary. They're books that you've read before. They were part of underclass studies. None of them actually have much of anything to do with mortal economics or tax theory in any way. But then again, there appear to be a few books missing.
Can I look for a book that maybe touched more than the other books? Does that make sense? Maybe there's a book that'll trigger something.
Mm-hmm. Yep, that makes sense. Give me a brains roll.
Okay. Ooh, that was worse. That's a 5 total.
Okay. No, they all look... Most of the books look fairly well worn. There's a few that look almost new, however.
Okay. I turn to Desmond and I say, "Well, what did you find?"
A book.
Oh, okay. Well, there's a lot of books in here.
It hasn't been opened before, though, and the title of the book is
insert title.
Mm-hmm.
The title of the book is what languages do you speak?
Definitely just English.
Okay, the title of the book is in a language that you do not speak.
I'm going to say I have rudimentary French, but, like, not a lot. Like, I can ask where the bathroom is.
It is not in French either.
Neat. Then, yeah, I just held up a book and say, this book.
Can I roll to see if I recognize the language?
Yeah.
I rolled a one.
Nice.
Okay. You do not recognize. You can spend adversity tokens, remember. Only your own, because this is still, I believe, in a snap decisions. But I don't think that you will have three, so that's probably not going to make much of a difference. Anyway, you look at the language on it, and you can't quite pin it down. It's using a different letter set than you're used to. It's not working off of the standard letters that you're used to, or even ones from other alphabets that you've heard of.
Huh.
While they're both sort of considering the book in all of its facets, Barnabas opens up his robe, and his little capuchin monkey familiar sort of scampers up to his shoulder, and he goes, and sends his capuchin monkey to go over to the giant conspiracy wall and start moving pins around to just make it get all messed up. And then he goes over to the group to join in.
Hey, so what's with the book?
I don't know anything about this book. So here's what I learned by looking at those So what I learned is that it all sort of comes to that bookshelf.
Okay.
Well, I don't know. There's something about the bookshelf.
Maybe there's something behind it, like a secret door.
I could try and unlock it again. And I pull out my wand.
I point. I'm like, yeah.
Hello, Pa!
I try to unlock the book. This way, I don't have any idea what's going on, so I'm just shooting blind.
Wow. Okay. Cool. You try to unlock the bookcase. Okay, so make me that roll.
Sure. This feels pretty charming, right? I mean, I think we're all pretty charmed about this experience.
No. No. This is definitely going to be a flight, because you're trying to do it stealthily, I assume. Not just bash it down.
Definitely. Okay. Yeah. Okay, so flight. Here we go. Whoop. That's a six. That's another six.
Oh my gosh.
That's another six! That's another six!
No, what even?
That's a three. So, I don't know, George. Does 29 do it? I don't really know. I don't.
If this bookshelf doesn't have a door, it should become one. We should.
I don't think you rolled a 29, though. I think math says
6, 12, 18, 24 plus 3 is 27, and I have a plus 2 in flight.
Oh, you have a plus 2 in flight. Okay, then yeah, that's a 29. Wow.
I don't do her.
I got a 29.
You did.
I did it.
All right, so apparently Barnabas is like the best wizard at this school.
Okay.
Well, I'm just breaking in. I'm a little
and
thief.
And then you roll a d4 for your magic die.
Oh no! I remember what happened last time I rolled this. That sounds about right. So that's a three.
Okay. So you point your wand, and this is not a door, so it does not unlock.
Okay, so this is really intriguing. Why don't we, I think we've been here a little long.
I turn my nose into a dog nose and I try and sniff the books and see if I can get anything.
At this point, then Barnabas will turn back to the wall and go, Mr. Pebbles, no! And grab his monkey and leave the scene.
So, Mr. Pebbles, you see him pulling out pins and poking them back in other places.
Yeah,
and as he does, you see the pins pull itself out and go back to the original positions.
Oh.
Neat.
Wow, that was smart. All right, Mr. Pebbles, back in your place. And I shove him back into my robe.
Goes in and then becomes silent.
All right, Desmond, give me your brains roll.
All right. 4.
Yes.
No, wait. You said brains.
Yes.
4.
Yes.
And 1. So 5.
5. Okay.
But I did polymorph, so I get pluses to that.
And it's a and it is a magical effect, so roll that extra d4 for your magic boost.
Ooh. 3.
So what is your total?
3 plus 2 plus 5 is
math.
10.
It's 10. Thank you.
All right. With your 10, you smell the bookshelf? Is that what you're smelling?
I'm smelling, yeah, around like the bookshelf and stuff. I'm trying to smell like the books and stuff and seeing if anything strikes me as different.
Okay.
I mean,
as you do, you catch a whiff of a similar scent, and the books that appeared newer on this shelf have a similar scent to the one that you found.
I grab these books.
Okay.
I say, these books are different, and I point them at Amelia because they're books and I don't know what to do with these.
Okay.
What kind of books are they? Are they also in different languages?
No, these are all in English. At least the covers are. I mean, if you take time to read them all, that might be a different story, but...
Well, sure, yeah.
The covers are all in English, and they're all rudimentary books that do not have to deal with tax theory or anything of the sort.
Go like this with them.
And how many empty spots in the bookshelf are there?
There are 3.
Okay. You know what, Desmond? Why don't you put those back? Put them in bed. Keep putting them.
Okay, but I'm going like this in case there's anything inside them. That's all. Another coming back.
You shake the books, and nothing seems to rattle within it.
I assume this is something you have to use your brains for, but Desmond desperately doesn't want to have to do that, so he's like, "Come on, physical world."
Yeah, Kate's stuck with 2 dummies, so if he doesn't figure this out, this place is going to be destroyed.
All right, yeah, okay. I put him back.
We
should spy on her when she comes back.
Okay, here's what I want you to do. Okay?
I love it, I say as I run over towards the entranceway to start looking around to see if anybody's coming.
Well, we should really get going, but the lust for knowledge. Okay, so you're going to take this book, and I pick up the one that he had found originally that's in the weird language, mm-hmm. and I shove it in Desmond's face, and I say, can you... sniff around for more of these books in here? Are there more somewhere besides the bookshelf? No?
Why don't you put that book on the shelf? Goes back to looking in the window.
Well, that's... Yeah, I was gonna... You're right. You're so smart. Okay. I'm gonna go put it in one of the empty...
And I put mine back already.
Okay. There are 3 open slots. There's one in the first row, one in the third row, and one at the bottom row. Which do you put the book into?
Do I remember where I got mine from?
Well, yeah, I would assume if you choose to remember where you took the books from.
That's... I'm gonna roll. If I get a 1, I don't remember.
Okay.
Fair. We're pretty big.
I don't remember.
Oh, no.
Oh, my God.
Time for a book puzzle.
Are there any books around it that look similar to this one?
In terms of language, no, but in terms of the material that they're made of, you can make me a brains roll.
Brains? Okay. That's 13.
Okay, 13 total?
Yeah.
Great. You are examining those books. The material seems similar to the new one that Desmond was pulling out, and they seem to be either on the bottom shelf or the top one.
Okay, I'm just going to put it on the bottom.
Okay. You put it on the bottom shelf. And as you do, you feel something as it starts to go in, and the book does not slide all the way into the shelf.
Put it in the top.
You put it in the top, and similarly, as it starts to go back, it doesn't quite go all the way in.
Yeah. You have to push all the way.
I know how to put it.
You gotta push all the way.
I know. Oh, I pull the book out. I'm gonna reach in the slot. Can I feel anything back there?
Yes, you can. As you reach inside, you can feel what appears to be almost flush with the back, a box-like shape pressed against the wall of the bookshelf.
I turn to them. I say, look, feel.
Which one?
The one I just put my hand in.
No, look or feel.
Oh,
feel.
Yeah.
I feel. Just yeah. put your, just please, just.
I go, I don't understand why she's getting so incredulous. I'm like, I don't know.
You said Rich. Two sensations. Yeah, and Barnabas is still just like being lookout at the door. He's just trying to check to see if anybody's coming.
Give me your brains roll, Barnabas.
Ooh, perfect. We like that. That's definitely my strong suit. And I was right. 3.
Okay. So Desmond, do you look or do you feel?
I feel.
Okay. You similarly feel that box-like shape.
I try and tug at it. Okay. What am I getting? Turn my hands into raccoon hands. What does it look like?
Does it make it
okay,
harder?
So far we have established that you can transform into dog and raccoon. That is 2 of your 6 animals established.
Fair.
Yeah. I remember.
Mm-hmm. I'm pretty sure you also established something in the pregame, but that's fine. Okay. We'll remember it.
I've also established that I forget and replace. But for this session, yes, raccoon and dog are 2.
Okay, so, you don't even need your little raccoon hands, but you do it anyway because you're a polymorph-obsessed fool, mm-hmm. and you reach inside and you pull out what appears to be a small wooden box made out of some kind of dark mahogany.
I say, it feels like some kind of mahogany box, and then I take it out and go, yep, I hand it to you.
Ah, and thank you, Walrus and Megiddo, Octopus, Rat, whatever crippled that kid. So, elephants or hippo.
Hippopotamus.
So we've got yeah. Octopus, Rat,
yeah,
or Mouse, Hippo, Raccoon, and Dog.
Okay. I'm probably a bird.
Good stuff.
I got the pigeon form. I know I've all got right. that mm-hmm. one. Can't mm-hmm. forget about pigeon.
Anyway, you now have a box.
I reach into the other ones.
Which one do you reach into?
Well, she was having trouble with the bottom one, right?
Okay. You reach in and you feel a similar box at the back of that.
I take that out.
Okay. That one is smaller than the other.
Nice. Before I reach out, I go, yeah, this one's definitely smaller. I go, yep. I hand it over.
Okay. Wait a minute.
I'm reaching the last one. Anyway.
You reach into the last one. There is no box at the end of it. Instead, you find what seems to be a small hole.
Hmm. Well, I definitely try and put my hands further in there.
A small hole, like like pencil size.
Yeah. Can I try and like?
Sure. You can stick your little raccoon claws in there. Sure.
You
why not?
Around. You knew
George,
it was
do you
coming.
Regret this yet?
I do. Every day of my life, I regret this.
This is cloud 9 for me. Kate is in her own puzzle nightmare, while Rich and I are just like the biggest buffoons, and George has to go with us. He's giving us agency to choose the world.
Yep. Anyway, you feel around inside the hole. It doesn't seem like there's any kind of mechanisms within it, so it doesn't feel like a lock.
There's a small hole back here. Should we do like a shrinking spell and check it out?
Oh my gosh. I really think that I think we've been here long enough. And look, I am intrigued. I am absolutely intrigued by this.
So you want to know what's in the hole?
Well, I do, but I also
perfect.
But is it doesn't
come wow! Shrinking spell on Amelia.
No. No.
On Amelia. Okay, so now we get into what is affecting another living creature with your magic. Mm-hmm. This is not simply you rolling. Instead, we determine what the roll is going to be, and then both of you roll it. And then whoever gets the higher number either resists the effect or...
Oh, yeah.
So, shrinking. That is... what would you say? Would you say that's brains or flight?
I would say flight because I feel like you use it more in, like, hidey kind of situations.
I could agree
with
that.
I need to get in there and, like, look around.
Okay. So this is going to be a flight magical effect. This is definitely not something that's natural. So this is going to have a modifier of reality bending. So that's plus 5.
Makes sense.
The effect is a person, so that's plus 3. So the target number is 8 so far. What is the duration that you're going for?
2 minutes.
2 minutes. Okay, so that is a plus 1, so we're at a 9. And have you done this
3
before?
3 minutes!
And have you done this before?
Have I shrunk anything?
Shrunk anybody.
Probably me.
He's probably at least shrunk adjacent.
I've shrunk functions. Me, but that's it. Like, I've never shrunk anybody else. So,
so you have not done it. So
perfect.
Now, what about you, Amelia? Have you shrunk somebody else before?
I mean, probably not. Like, I think if anything, I have shrunk inanimate objects in my studies.
Okay. Teacups.
So, no, I'm going to say I haven't done this yet, although sometimes I do try to drag Barnabas and Desmond into my, like, studies and practice on them, but not shrinking yet.
So that's probably where I learned this spell.
Okay, so...
Oh, you son of a bee.
Desmond, your target number for this role is a... number that I forgot. It is a 14.
All right, come on, that's 20. Don't fail me now.
Now, meanwhile, Amelia, you do the opposed roll, and if you roll higher than him, it doesn't have you resist the effect. His roll is determining if things go bad.
Ooh, no. Was that good?
No.
17.
Nope. I rolled a 5.
Looks like you're going in the hole.
I don't want to go in the hole.
You're going in the hole.
All right, so... With a 5, you cast the spell, but not impressively. Sure, it works, but it's clear that the character put serious effort into making it succeed. It does function as expected. So what happens?
I scoop up the... I can't hear your protests anymore, so I go, I can't hear you. But I pick you up in my tiny raccoon hands, I put you all the way back to the hole and go, hurry up, it only lasts another 100 seconds.
Meanwhile, Barnabas, because of your amazing brains roll earlier while you were keeping lookout, you do notice somebody coming. Professor Melinda Cosgrove, you see her walking down the hall toward the office.
Oh, no.
Because you unfortunately did not roll high enough to hear her in advance.
So she's like, so I see her like coming down the hallway. Mm-hmm. So she's like on, she's inbound. Okay.
Yep.
Okay.
Meanwhile, Amelia, you are now shrunk and in a bookshelf.
I guess I'm really upset and angry about it, but I'm going to go to that hole.
Okay. You walk to the back of the bookshelf. You see the knot in the wood in the back of the bookshelf. What do you do?
Wait, what do I see?
A knot, you know, like one, you know, looking at the wood, there's that little hole that sometimes occurs in wood.
Yeah. I touch it, like push at it.
Okay, well, it's been excised. It's like a hole now. So yes, you are able to get inside of it if you want. But...
Oh sure. I look in there.
Okay, you stick your head into the hole in the wood. It's very dark. I don't think there's any light source that you have on you or in the back of this bookshelf.
Can I use my tiny little wand?
Sure.
I'm going to cast a tiny light spell.
Okay. You're going to cast a tiny a tiny light spell.
Yeah. No, go ahead. What were you going to say?
Light is something that could happen naturally, so that's a plus 1. It's a small effect. Book size are similar, so plus 1, so we're at 2. How long would you like it to last?
Oh, a minute at most.
Okay, so it's plus one, so we're at three. And have you done this before?
Oh, I'm sure I've done this before.
Constantly,
yeah.
I'm
this
sure.
Is, this, yeah.
So you need a three on this brains roll.
Good thing I got a six.
Oh my gosh.
We're doing well.
Okay, so again, you cast it, but not terribly impressively, unfortunately.
That's okay. I'm not trying to impress any ants.
So what kind of light do you summon?
I would say that I just try to summon light at the tip of my wand. Just like nothing too bright, but soft enough that I can maybe get a general idea of what's going on in here, if anything.
Okay. So you, your wand flashlight, you poke it into the hole and you look around at the edges of wood. And you see at the very back of it what looks like a tiny key embedded in the back of the hole.
Huh. Okay.
Oh, Vec has redeemed, raised the stakes.
I've got my giant face in the
hole. All right, Vec. Yeah, all right. Yeah. Vec, do you have a suggestion on how to raise the stakes?
Oh, Beck.
Or are you giving me free reign here?
No, Beck, please Becky, don't give him free reign.
Becky,
I believe in you.
Becky.
This is killing me.
Okay, she has nothing, so that's on me. All right, Barnabas.
Yes.
You see, trailing behind... Subscribe to... Tier 3, Walrus. Wow. Thank you so much. Wow.
My man.
Thank you. Vec, you see trailing... Barnabas, you see trailing behind the professor, you see Sir Reginald Kensington.
Stop.
As well as Quilliam Jr. The son of the... Professor of Spirit Manifestation.
Oh, this just got bad. Okay. So, Barnabas, seeing this, goes,
Des, we're about to have company. I think a lot of company.
Meanwhile,
I got an idea, though.
And Amelia.
I have more things to do, but go on.
Yes,
also,
meanwhile, Amelia.
I should point out that, yeah, real quick, before I shrunk, my raven, obviously, I would say, did not shrink with me and, like,
sure.
Came out of, you know, and is now like perched probably on Desmond and is kind of poking at your head a little bit, not to like hurt you, but like defiantly.
Hey, I speak in Raven to it and I'm like, hey, can you, we're working.
Meanwhile, Amelia, you begin to feel the magics of Desmond's effect wearing off. Did you do anything in the hole?
No, I honestly, I mean, what can I do, really? So I'm just going to take note of what I saw.
Could
so
she
it's...
have reached the key?
Probably.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, I should have asked. It sounded like it was far back or something.
I mean, it would take effort to, like, grab
it.
Yeah,
sure.
But...
Or magic. Nice, yeah, see? You get it.
What?
Or magic.
Yeah, but would she... Oh, she's too curious. Okay. I would try to grab it. So should I use, like, brawn?
Yes. Use brawn to try to grab it.
Okay.
Oh, I
to
bet
try to wrench it out of the
I'm
back.
I'm so good at that.
Yeah, I bet you're as good at brawn as we are with brains.
I got a three. So that's my
right.
D4.
Did you use magic? Oh, no, you're just pulling.
She's just pulling.
Yeah.
Okay. You reach back in and you start to try to get your fingers around it, but it is so flush with the actual wooden surface that it's hard to actually force your fingers in there. And you feel now the magic almost at its end.
Oh gosh. Okay, now I'm I don't want
What do you do?
Can I tell you what I'm doing?
Almost at her end?
Yes, Barnabas, you can tell me what you're doing.
So Barnabas says to Desmond as he sees them coming, I've got an idea. I'm going to give it a try. And he goes over to her desk and he grabs as much of her like papers and stuff that are scattered about. And he gives them to Mr. Pebbles. He shakes him out of his robe and he goes, take these. And Mr. Pebbles takes them. And he goes, oh, what? Look like a little creepy homunculus thing. And then he's going to try and cast to make Mr. Pebbles look like a weird, like artificially made creature instead of like a little monkey.
Okay.
What do I roll to make him look different? That sounds like a charm, right? That sounds like an effect to change the appearance, so it like affects people. It charms people, right? Probably. Maybe.
I don't know. What do you think? Is this charm or brains?
I think charm.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. I'll allow it. This is
excellent
reality brain. Breaking.
Excellent.
This is a small person, so we're at 10. How long do you want this to last?
For like a minute.
A minute. Okay. So we're at 11. And have you turned him into a homunculus thing before?
I've probably changed his appearance before.
Yeah.
It's a glamour is what it is.
Would you say this is something you've cast
Mr. Pebbles,
or something that you've mastered?
Are you an illusionist by trade? Do you like illusions?
I think I'm a prankster. So I think these kind of aspects are more so my forte. I think Barnabas is a trickster. I don't think I mastered it because I don't think Barnabas is that good in school and magic in general, but I think I have used it enough.
Okay.
So I'm familiar with it. I'm not mastered.
You're at a 12 for your difficulty of your charm roll.
Okay. Okay. Okay.
And don't forget that extra D4.
Of course. Right.
Meanwhile, Amelia, what do you do?
So here's what I'm going to do. I mean, I could just like make something up and then you roll with it, right? As long as it's reasonable, like as far as a magic effect. Okay. Mm-hmm. So I'm almost going to do what I would think is it's like similar to a mage hand. And once I cast it, I'm going to freaking run. So I'm just kind of hope for the best because this shouldn't affect. Okay. So here's what I'm doing. I'm casting something that like I want to like summon a hand that'll grab the key. And hopefully, you know, grab it and whatever, because that doesn't need to get big. Like, grab it and then, like, float to me, kind of.
Mm-hmm.
You get me?
A little telekinesis.
Yeah,
sort of. Tether.
Right. Yeah, something like that. And then, like, literally, as soon as I'm done casting it, I'm going to run and just be like, I hope it worked, you know?
Okay. So,
kind of thing.
For this magical effect, I'm sure that you're trying to negotiate this to brains.
Yeah.
Yeah? But now here's the question. Are you pulling it with the force of your mind, or are you sending a hand that's going to try to do what you did?
I'm not. My thought was that it's more like tethered to my wand, so it's more of like a magical thinky-do effect. Like,
magic comes from her brain.
It does come from
all
my
magic
brain.
Is brain.
I feel like, you know, I get where you're coming from, George. I would say,
yeah,
I agree. But I could also argue that it would.
But
be
it is more it, because
or
it's yeah, it's like a telekinetic kind of thing. Mm-hmm. So that's it's like
force
of
will.
Yeah. It's a force.
Okay,
of will.
So it is your force of will doing it.
Yeah.
Okay, then you can give me that brains roll.
Okay.
And it is pretty well, it could happen, but not naturally. So it's plus 3, tiny, plus 1. Okay. How long do you want this tether to last?
Not long at all. Like maybe 30 seconds, because the idea is once I'm out of the bookshelf, I'm going to like.
So the thresholds are instantaneous, a few minutes, an hour, a day.
Oh,
a week,
gotcha.
Permanent.
Okay. So just like a couple minutes.
Yeah. Okay. So plus 1.
Okay.
So we are at 3, 4, 5. Now, have you done a magical tether before like this? Or have you witnessed somebody do something similar?
I've probably done something similar. Like, you know, my tea is all the way over there. So I'm going to like, you know, use the hand to bring the tea over. But I will give you that, like, I'm a distracted. Like, once I cast it, I'm going to be running. So, like, it's probably more difficult because I'm, you know, the stakes are higher, you know?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Okay. So, You are at a difficulty of 6. 6.
Okay.
For this roll.
All right.
And this roll is going to then impact the difficulty of your flight roll to try to escape from the bookshelf before you...
Yeah, that's fair. Destroy
explode
it.
Out of the bookshelf?
Mm-hmm. Okay. Now, meanwhile, Barnabas, what did you roll?
Rolled a 19 and a 2.
19 and a 2. Wow. Okay. So you transform your little monkey friend into a homunculus. As it does, as his form begins to change, you feel the bond weakening slightly as
well, and it's... just to clarify, it's really more glamour. I'm not doing like a true
really illusion.
So like, it's... make him look like a weird little homunculus monster, but it's still okay. Mr. Pebbles. It's still my monkey. I would never change his form.
Gotcha. Okay, so this is really just another... It's like a skin, a disguise that he's wearing.
Exactly, exactly. It's a disguise, yeah.
Okay. So as it happens, you can see it not quite lining up perfectly because it has to sit over him, otherwise he's going to clip through it.
Sure.
Monkey. Okay.
And then I will say, plan number 34C, all right? You spread all those papers out, run down the hallway to the left, make sure those people see you, and then get out of sight. You get 1 minute. Go!
And I will just crank the door open just a smidge for him to scamper through with the papers. And he's just throwing the papers and running.
Okay.
And then I close the door. Click. Lock the door.
Oh, you lock the door.
Mm-hmm.
Good note.
Oh my.
Okay. Give me your brains roll to see how well you impart that direction to your monkey.
Oh,
meanwhile, Amelia... How did you do on your brains roll?
I got a 16.
Okay.
Oh, wait, no. I roll a d4, right?
Yep.
I mean, I know. I don't. Okay. I got a 19.
Okay. You got a 19. You latch your tether onto the magical key, and then you begin running in the opposite direction. You feel the tether pull tight against you as it's yanked from its hiding place. Give me your flight roll.
Okay.
This is going to be hard because you've... ate a lot of time.
Okay.
Do I know that it's almost up?
Yes, probably.
Could I try and like grab her and be like, what are you doing?
Not at this point. It's probably a little too late.
Simultaneous action?
No, that's fine.
All right. Anyway, Barnabas, what did you get for your brains roll?
That was a 1.
Go, papers, go.
Okay. You send your... I'm going to copy this from A Rose in Jersey, your homunculus, out into the hall, and then you shut the door, clicking the lock from the inside.
Mr. Pebbles is going to buy us some time, but we're going to need to get out of here.
Yeah.
Okay.
I got Amelia. 7.
You got a 7 total?
Yeah, well, I don't add anything, right?
Nope. Okay.
I have a D10, so it's a good 7.
Yes, it is. Okay.
All things considered.
Well, we'll see.
You begin trying to run out of the bookshelf. You make it to the edge. You leap, and then you begin to grow. Your foot catches inside of the bookshelf as you do, and you thunk to the ground. Your clumsy nature.
Yeah, that's fair.
Coming to the forefront. Your foot is now wedged inside of that bookshelf.
Ooh.
Huh.
I'm just like, ow. And like looking desperately, trying to pull my
foot. Get her out of there.
All right. Gosh dang.
Sure.
What do you do?
I cast oaken legs and give her tree trunk legs.
No, what? What?
Let's see.
What are you doing?
Let's definitely make sure.
No,
that bookshelf is gone.
Let's see. No, I'll pull on the leg.
Okay, give me your brawn roll. Meanwhile, Barnabas, give me a brains roll.
Oh, you know I love to give you those. Mm-hmm. That's
hey, you chose lookout.
Oh, shoot. Okay, well that's the first 4. A 7.
Okay, a 7. You hear some yelling from out in the hall, and then you hear it stop and change to some mild cursing as you hear the rustling of papers.
It's right outside the door.
You then hear something just jiggling the doorknob.
We gotta get out of here now. It's time to go.
And Barnabas is going to scramble over to the window. I assume there's a window.
Oh,
in this office.
My gosh.
Is there a window? No, this is an interior office.
Oh.
That's how I pictured it in my mind.
So no.
we're trapped.
We're fine. I have an idea. But anyway, I got a 7 to pull her out. I don't know if that does it.
Yeah, I mean, it's just wedged between, like, books and stuff. So as you pull, the books begin to shift, and you pull her foot out. A few of the books topple out as well.
All right, in Monkey, I go, Mr. Pebbles, is that you on the other side of the door?
You say that?
Yeah, I can speak to animals freely.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay. Yes, you hear him talk back. Well, yes, it is me, sir. Thank you for speaking to me. Would you kindly let me in to this office?
I just very quickly open the door and then, like, slam it.
The door
closed.
Is locked.
I unlock the door.
Okay. You unlock the door. You open the door. And you see a homunculus out in the hall. It scampers inside. You see that it ran out into the hall, scattered all of the papers in one spot, and then turned around and ran back inside.
I say to him, a monkey, great job. You did the best you could with that direction. And
I... Mr. Pebbles, what are you doing? This isn't Plan 34C.
Meanwhile, during that quick, brief glance, you can see Professor Cosgrove picking up her papers, and you can see Quilliam Jr. laughing at her behind her back, and aww. Sir Reginald is tapping on his little cellular device that he brought back with him from the mortal world.
Weird.
Ooh.
All right.
I grab Mr. Pebbles and stuff him back into my robe.
What do we do? Oh, I knew we were here too long. I should have just gone. I don't know why I let you guys do this stuff.
It's
I don't
fine,
know why I let myself
fine,
do
fine.
This stuff with you guys. What are we supposed to do?
Yeah,
got an idea.
Picking up papers like a bunch of idiots. Uh-oh. We got this.
All right.
What are we going to say to them?
I start casting invisibility. I'm like, guys, you guys are the...
So you're trying to get everybody?
Actually,
I shake my head no fervently enough.
I say to Barnabas, I say, cast invisibility on yourself, and I cast invisibility on Amelia. Ooh!
Hang on. What is invisibility going to be? That's probably
flight,
going...
for sure.
Fright. Light. Good choice. Okay, so, a flight roll. That is a reality-bending effect, plus 5. That is a person, plus 3. That's 8. How long do you want it to last?
And what are the options again? Hours? Or
yeah, minutes, hours, days, instant.
Instant minute, hours,
59
days.
Minutes.
Cool, 1 hour. It's plus 2. And have you cast and have you cast
nice
invisibility
try.
Before?
Yeah, invisibility is something that I'm used to because it's a...
Is it
like
something that you've
effect.
Mastered?
No, I've okay. not. Besides polymorphing, nothing is mastered.
So we're at 3, 6, we're at 11.
Okay. I got a...
And Amelia, you will roll the same roll that he rolls to see if it affects you.
Okay.
Is she resisting?
That's
Are you resisting?
Automatic.
Oh, really?
It's your natural impulse to resist magical effects.
And that was
flight, we had
enough
of this world, I believe you.
I mean, there's literally no way I can beat it. Unless I got a million.
I got a
20 dice.
Total.
Oh. Jesus. It was flight?
Yeah, I got a base 19 plus 1 on the die for it.
Well, I rolled an 8.
Okay. So, you do manage to get her to turn her invisible. It's quite impressive. To anybody watching, it seems like the spell has been mastered. The spell functions perfectly. And Amelia is now invisible.
And then
Barnabas.
I look at Barnabas. I do put my hand on her, because that way she doesn't, like, go away and I know where she is.
As Barnabas is just drenched in sweat as he's pointing the wand at his face and just...
Okay.
And I'm gonna just do like a minute of invisible time.
Okay.
And I rolled a 3 for a 5.
Cool.
Oh god. Okay, so you rolled good a stuff. 5. You had a difficulty of 1 lower, so you only had a 10 because you reduced that. Which means you failed by 5. Which means the spell fails in a benign burst of magic. So,
get my arms.
You attempt your invisibility spell on yourself, and as And as you do, it explodes in a fairy dust-like effect as glitter spurts from your wand, covering your face, and clearly going to be there forever.
I think I'm actually blind!
Okay. So, Amelia is invisible. Barnabas is now a walking disco ball. We have a flying raven in the office, and we have a monkey and a Desmond. When you hear a key begin to turn in the door.
I say to the raven, like, or actually I tell your raven to come to me now. And I reach out my hand.
Yeah, and I'm like, go, please. Bill, the raven.
Barnabas is just like, it's everywhere!
Mr. Pebbles, help!
A little monkey paw comes out from, like, the top and just starts, just like, also clawing at his face. I'm not helping!
Does he break the skin? Do you now have blood mixing with the glitter? And
he starts scratching. Yeah, it starts scratching and stuff.
The glitter is now working its way into your wounds, which is...
Yeah.
But now that means that I feel that too.
Yeah, you're feeling all of this.
So I'm trying to keep my cool.
All right, I'm going to need a grit roll from you, Amelia.
I'm sorry, I had to say something.
Yeah, you got stinging
eyes.
Hey,
the chat sold it out too.
And your face is starting to feel like it's getting torn asunder.
I got a 7.
Slapped around a bit. Yeah.
Okay, you can manage to keep your composure through it if you choose to, as it's really just monkey scratches.
And Barnabas will say while he's just fighting his own pain, "Get out of here, Jess! I'll deal with it." And I'm just probably falls, hits his head on the desk.
I turn into a giant octopus and slam myself into the corner of the room and mimic the background.
Okay, well, actually, that's pretty legit.
So, how does the raven help there?
I put it behind me because I don't want it to be seen.
Aha. Uh-huh.
I don't want Amelia's raven to get caught out.
And where's your familiar?
Oh, he's on my person. He's used to all this. I have like a little papoose. It's a badger.
How big are they?
Not little. They're like yay big.
Okay, so you need to hide a raven and a badger behind yourself.
I'm a giant octopus. They're not called giant octopuses because they're small.
Okay, this is going to be a flight. So this is a flight effect. It is something reality bending. It is bigger than a person, I would believe, at that point, right?
Do you want me to Google it, guys?
How big is an octopus?
They're
pretty. Depends on the type, right?
Yeah. The biggest octopus I can be.
Octopus sizes.
Let's see.
They're pretty big. They're 110 pounds. That is not a little octopus.
Okay, but that's still human size. So it's small.
Yeah, medium. I would say medium if we were.
Like, so that's 8. How long do you need that to last?
Oh, well, this is a polymorph effect, so I'm just doing it. So I imagine it, like, I don't think they turn off until you turn them off. So I would say this would be another hour one at least. It's fine.
Well,
I would take
so
it on that.
If this is a permanent, is this a permanent effect until you turn it off?
Let's just go with, let's not anamorph ourselves here. So we'll say they last for an hour until you get tired. And
yeah,
it's like kind of like constricting muscles. So eventually you're just like,
okay. So that's plus 2, so we're at 10 so far. And you've done octopus.
This is the one thing I'm like, yeah, I got this, yeah.
Yep, okay. So you have a 10 as your target number.
The magic dice can't explode, right?
No.
I didn't think so.
Well, he's got to roll stat and then the magic dice, right?
Correct.
I did, but this is flight. So flight I did. So I'm just rolling the magic dice. So that is a total of 23.
Okay. All right, you turn... into an octopus, you grab the raven and the papoose and press yourself up against a section of wall that's fairly similarly colored or solidly colored so that you can easily transform into it, and you hope that they don't notice.
And I say, it's okay, Bill. It'll be okay, Bill.
I put one of my raven tentacles over Amelia's mouth.
Oh, wait.
Ew.
You grab Amelia, too?
I have, like, so no, essentially as I swap I say, back, I just have a thing on her because I want to know where she is.
I say it, like, once.
I mean, okay. I don't think he's trying to cover your mouth. I think he's trying to make sure he knows where you are.
Yeah.
All right.
So it was more just a gross thing that was happening.
Yeah, you got a little tentacle on your shoulder.
Okay, that's going to be a little harder to disguise, but all right.
Well, then I move it away. I'm pretty sure
that octopus use their camouflage by pressing up against things, not just floating in mid-water.
That's a good point.
Well, generally, that's how they do it, but it's also great. it's not dependent on what they're pressed against. They actually have complete control over the melanin and all that stuff in their skin.
Yeah.
Well, I can see you, so I'm gonna be like.
Can you? That was a pretty good roll.
I saw you moving. I'm aware of what's happening.
We are on the same side.
I'll be near like a corner. Are you? Either way.
All right, Barnabas. Do you do anything aside from claw your glitter face?
I
come on, Barney, come on.
I fight my way to the door while like blinded and just tearing up, and the monkey's like sort of just like rubbing my face. I'm like, stop it, Mr. Pebbles. It's not helping anymore. You're only hurting. And I try and like shove his hand back down, and I get to the door to open it and burst out of the door, just swinging it open.
Okay. As you reach the door, you hear the key turn, the latch open, the door begin to open.
And I will purposely burst out of the room. Still in the same glorious setup that I am in, which is just pretty much crying with a face full of magical dust in my way, and what looks to be small tiny hand cuts along my face.
Is Mr. Pebbles in monkey form now or homunculus?
The homunculus form probably faded, but I've also tucked him back into my robe. So like okay. The glimmer of like a hand coming out of like the neck hole. Probably
yep.
Just like dust. Fading out as I stumble out, and I'm like, it's in my monkey wounds. And I just kind of just stumble out and probably fall on at the feet of the professor.
Okay, you can give me a brawn roll, I guess, to try to get past.
I mean, yeah, sure, I guess. I don't even know if I'm trying to get past at this point. I think now Barnabas.
Well, this is completely. Just, what are you doing?
He's falling on the sword. He's falling on the sword.
Yeah, I get it.
Because if anybody here is to fall on the sword, it's probably Barnabas.
Okay, then in that case, I need a charm roll to sell it.
Okay, very well, very well.
Does he have pluses for this? He's bleeding.
He is literally suffering right now.
He was also in a locked office where he should not have been.
I rolled an 8 for a 10.
Oh. Okay. You fall to the ground at the feet of Professor Cosgrove.
You get plus one for this, though, because you're innocent, because you're a child.
I got an 11.
Okay. So, she looks down at you, her brow furrowing, as she stares at you. You can see it poking around her side. Well, maybe you can see if you can see past your blood and glitter.
I got
Quilliam Jr.
Who is that? Can you help me? And my eyes are like, you know, just like probably glazed shut from the.
Then in that case, you hear the snickering of Quilliam Jr.
Who's laughing at me? I'm not your block off. And I take a swing and fall again.
Mr. Puck. You can stop the antics now. I am well familiar with your tune.
Professor, is that you?
Would you kindly...
I think I'm permanently blind now.
Would you kindly return to my office?
I don't know. I don't think I'm supposed to be in there.
Indeed not. So why were you?
I was looking for you. And I'm glad I found you. I wanted to ask for some extra notes from your last class. It's been ended shorter and shorter each time, and I wanted to get some extra help. Oh, this dust hurts so much, Professor.
And for your edification, she rolled an 18 on her brain's roll to see through it.
No, that sounds right.
And how, may I ask, did you get inside my locked office? to ask for this assistance.
Was it locked? I don't remember that. Must have been luck, I guess. I thought you were in there, and I thought I'd just wait in there. And
interesting that my office was the only one still locked on this hall. In this wing, from what I've heard.
That is interesting, Professor. Can you help me? My eyes are burning pretty fierce.
I'm sure we can get you some help inside the office.
All right. Then you're just going to have to help me because I can't really see too well.
And I'll start reaching out to try and, like, grab the professor and then allow her to sort of, like, guide me. Stalling as much as I can for hopefully whatever is going to happen for them.
Okay. So you... We got a baby check, so we have that
there. Yeah, we do.
So, you reach out for the professor's hand, and she grips it not gently, and leads you back into the office, and you feel a little kicking at the back of your heels as Quilliam Jr. is following you in.
Your grip's so firm, Professor. Also, whoever's behind me, if you keep touching my heels, I'm going to knock your block off.
As I just get dragged into the...
I don't think Daddy'd like it that much.
Oh, is that Quilliam Jr.? Oh, of course it'd be that sniveling brat on my heels. You've always been jealous, Quilliam. Well, wow, not so tough, Professor.
I ain't the one with little scratches on the face and covered in magic glitter, now am I?
He doesn't say anything in response, but under his breath he goes, "You will be soon."
What does it even mean?
Gonna get him.
Outstanding.
And the two of you, as well as... Is Reginald Kensington knighted?
Yes.
Sir Reginald Kensington,
yeah.
Make their way into the office. Sir Kensington enters last and shuts the door behind the group.
Oh, he's moving. I love him.
And what do you do?
Barnabas just probably just sniffles and, like, tries to wipe more arcane glitter off of his face.
Okay. The professor, the others there can see, makes her way over to her desk. And let's see if she notices all of the havoc that you have wreaked within this office.
It was just light pranks, light pranks.
She does not with her roll of one.
Wow.
Future her is going to suffer later.
Yep.
Those fruit flies are going to do their own work.
She takes a seat at her desk.
Mr. Puck, come here, please.
Okay, and I'm going to purposely walk into a chair and fall over because I'm blinded from the glitter and go,
oh, God, oh, Professor, my eyes, Professor.
I'm going to help your eyes, but I've already seen through your ruse, Mr. Puck. There's no need for you to continue the charade.
This is a charade. I've genuinely got glitter glazing my eyes shut.
Oh, I'm sure you do. I can see that plain as day, and we're going to find out why you have glitter on your face soon enough.
She pulls out her wand, waves it at you, and attempts a burst of water at your face to wash away the glitter.
Is she about to shoot me in the face with water?
Oh, yes!
Gosh, she what is. A good professor.
Why?
Oh!
Oh, no!
Oh, Naveen! Uh-oh. Thank you so much!
Sweet Naveen.
Okay, here we go.
I thought it was to clean the glitter, but you're getting waterboarded now.
Let's see like how she does.
Seared off. I got no skin now.
The water splashes. Actually, before I continue, Naveen, do you have a request for how it's going to be raised? Or are you going to give me free reign here?
Naveen, please. Make it something nice. Cupcakes come out of the wand. Yeah, you can. Raise the stakes for them.
No.
The teacher.
That's not how that works.
That's a nice dream, though. That's a nice dream.
That one's more
expensive. You gotta wake up.
Hmm.
Yeah, raise the stakes in the favor of the players. I want that reward.
Let yeah, where's that
everybody
one?
Comment and subscribe and
comment,
say
like, and
more assistance for the players.
Okay.
We clearly need it.
So Naveen has left it into my hands. So, as the water splashes against your face, you can feel it washing away the glitter and the water, and you feel something else. Give me a grit roll, please.
You about to get tortured?
Scorpions.
Nailed it. Rolled a two.
As you feel some of the water begins to make its way into your monkey wounds, and your head begins to grow a little light as you are affected with a truth spell, unable to lie.
Okay. I can see a lot better now. Thanks, Professor.
That's good. Now, what were you doing here?
I was causing all sorts of mischief. I tried to mess around with your pins over there, and it didn't really take so well. Your pins don't move. I had Mr. Pebbles. I had Mr. Pebbles move your pins, but they kept moving back. That's sort of dirty pool, Professor.
Sure, her eyes glance at the pins and then look at Sir Kensington. And then they go to Quilliam as well. And you were in here just to move the pins on my diagram?
No, I had other plans, actually.
What were those plans?
Can we make a brains roll to know he's... Is this something people do? Like, they're like, tell me the truth, child. Well, I am.
No, it's not often used.
So we wouldn't even think that this would happen, is my question. Like, is it a reasonable brains roll to be like, he would never say this
kind
of stuff.
It is a reasonable thing.
That's fair.
You can make a brains roll to see that this is probably not Barnabas's choice to be doing
this. Okay, I'm going to fail this, but hopefully Amelia doesn't. This was not.
Yeah, let's see.
No pressure.
I got a one, and I'm like, my dude would never sell me out.
I got plus one. 14.
Okay. Amelia, you've had enough interactions with Barnabas to know that this is... He's not usually this forthright about anything that he does, especially not to a professor. Anyway.
Barnabas. Not that I can do anything about it.
I don't know.
No, that wasn't it. Actually, I went through your desk and I took a whole bunch of papers out and I sent them outside. And also left little pieces of fruit all over your desk, like in the back spots where you never find them. You'll never find them. I mean, except now, because for some reason I'm telling you this. I don't really know why I'm telling you. Why am I telling you this, Professor?
You're telling me this because I need to know what you've gotten into in my office that you shouldn't have.
I mean, I don't think you needed to know, honestly, because really I didn't do any harm at the end of the day. I really just... made a little bit of mess.
And how did you get into my locked office?
Oh, I unlocked it. I'm good locked that.
And then relocked it.
Yeah. Yeah.
Hmm.
A master of crime. I mean, if there's anything that sells that this is just a doofy little boy doing doofy little boy stuff, it's the relocking after unlocking the whole way.
Walrus, I do not want to cast something right now.
Why my office?
Because I got a tip that you were, well, actually, I knew it myself because I'm in your class, but that you've been sort of stingy with the class time. Isn't that right, Professor? You've been a little stingy.
Hmm.
I mean, I don't think that's what a real professor should be doing. They should be doing the full class. I'm not sure if the headmaster would actually be so interested in that sort of thing. But I just wanted to check in myself, make sure you were on the up and up and doing okay. If something's wrong, you'd let me know, right, Professor?
She gives another look over to Kensington, who reaches down and touches the door.
What's he doing to the door? Because I'm by that corner.
You're by that corner? He locks the door.
Well, I'm by the back corner, So, like, towards the door, yeah.
He locks the door.
Oh, this is becoming concerning.
Uh-oh, I don't like that at all.
Oh, no, no, no.
Okay, I don't know if this is like D&D, but I'm super prepping an action.
No, you can take action.
I kind of am.
Yeah, what do you do?
So I just want to clarify that I don't turn into hippos anymore. I changed my hippo into a rhinoceros. So that's just a light thing.
I don't know, chat. Do we allow it?
Hippos and rhinoceros so far. And that happened a while ago. That was a story thing.
Actually, I'm sorry, Rich. Go ahead and finish your thought.
Well, I'm waiting. No, you keep going because I'm waiting for the chat to say whether or not I can do the thing.
Beck says no.
Becky.
Rishaka. Rishka. Sorry. Yeah. I'm horrible at pronouncing things.
That's okay. Hippo all the way.
Seems like the chat is in love with the hippo.
Hippos are brutal. So.
Hippos are far more brutal than
the
rhino.
They are.
All right, in which case, I am going to slither across the ceiling and make my way to being above the desk.
While managing
you're hiding
to keep...
too, yeah.
Well, is it the same color?
Well, no, the thing is, bringing the raven and the papushka, whatever it is, with you, without them slipping out.
It's probably harder. I'll make a reroll if you want. I got a 23, so it wasn't a bad roll, but I will roll it.
But I kind of.
I mean, I'll launch
keep
myself.
Talking if you guys want.
I mean, it's fine. No. At the end of the day, how big is the office? Can I reasonably launch myself in that direction?
Well. Oh, geez, how big is the office? Let's say that it is a moderately sized office. It is large enough for the teacher's desk, the professor's desk, as well as a side sitting area. So, yeah, it's probably... What are you trying to do, exactly?
Could I jump, in theory, could I launch myself as the octopus? And I'll let go of Raven at that point if I launch myself. But could I launch myself, let's say, to the desk?
To the desk. Sure. Yeah. You're close enough that you could launch yourself to the desk. Also, Megiddo, that is a fantastic idea. An exorcism or similar ritual to get rid of animal forms to see if you can fully purge yourself of past animal aspects. Good bit of lore to add in there.
I like that too.
Okay.
I don't remember if we established that. I don't think we
did,
but I think it's good now.
I'm going to do something.
All right,
you
Amelia.
Do something because I have a plan as well. So.
Okay.
I also have an idea.
Well, my plan is... I'm sorry.
oh no, when you lead a plan in with I'm sorry.
It's
a good sign. That's a good sign.
Since I'm near you, Rich, because we did, I established that, I'm going to lean down to where I assume you are, because I said I watched you go.
I'm up, I'm not down.
But I, what I'm saying, I don't want you to do this thing you're doing, okay? Well,
I'm up in the ceiling corner, but
well, hang on, you're not
you.
There yet until
No,
you...
I've been in the ceiling.
Oh,
like,
you were
I
at the ceiling
up.
That whole time? Okay.
Yeah, I sure. was... Because I wanted
sure,
to
not why
not. Have them come over. I
was like, he was like in a corner. He
yeah, like,
into a
like
corner.
Spider-Man.
I thought you were on the bottom corner.
So did I, but that's fine.
Yeah.
I don't care.
Okay, then knowing that, I'm going to
I was
like,
with you, Rich. I knew.
I'm going to, as quietly as I can, like whisper up. Huh? That's probably pretty far up. I don't want to be heard.
There are three people
it.
That.
Forget it. We're just going to, it's going
it
to be fine.
Go.
Because this is a distraction. Here's what I'm going to do. I am going to cast. I'm going to close my eyes. And I'm going to cast a spell to do a very, very blinding flash in this room. That will be longer than...
Oh, no!
No!
Oh, but the Bex got in first! Okay.
Oh, my gosh.
Okay, what is
that
happening?
Is three loaded dice!
We had three loaded dice. So the next dice roll, which is going to be Kate's spell, is going to be a one. The next roll after that is going to be 1,563,893.
Well,
followed by
a
four.
Didn't Rich have to roll to do what he... Oh, wait, he didn't move
I haven't
yet.
Done it. I
he
was
didn't
waiting
move
to take
yet.
My shoes off of you.
Oh, no.
I'm
well
die.
Done, Beck.
Remind me what adversity tokens are.
So you can spend adversity tokens in order to increase your die roll by one per token you spend.
Beck, you really screwed the pooch here.
Oh, boy. Hey, but that's fine. Walrus, your giant roll is going to help somebody.
Yeah.
Or the Barnabas or me.
They're going to be racing to get that next action in.
I might not, because I might kill a man. So.
I do have a question following whatever Kate does.
All right.
Well, that really stinks.
Yep.
So, yeah, it does.
Amelia, what is your... Let's see what happens.
Well,
your blinding flash.
I have a one, which is a two plus. Oh, wait, no, I guess it's just a one, right? I don't add anything.
No.
Okay, so it's a one. I tried to cast.
Okay, so you pull out your wand, you bring it forward, you make the flash, and it makes a flash of light the size that you were earlier.
That makes sense.
Yep.
Nice.
It is still, of course,
everyone
enough
in the room
to...
is like, oh, there's a glare in my eye.
What the heck was that?
Did you not say something to lead that in to warn them about the blinding flash?
No, I didn't, because I
know it's gonna be okay.
I actually ended up not saying anything. I'm not gonna say what my plan was, because I'm still probably gonna try it anyway, since that failed so terribly. Depending on how things go from here.
I would like to see if I may cash in my innocence.
What does your innocence do?
Innocence. Once per session, I can spend 2 adversity tokens to convince an adult to not put me in trouble for a minor transgression. Which, as of right now, all I have done is messed around with her place, which I couldn't actually do because it was magically defended, and put fruit in her desk.
Or this might not be a minor.
Yeah, this stopped being a minor infraction when you caused them to lock the door.
That's what I
mean. Come on!
By threatening to go to the headmaster.
I mean, I didn't threaten. I just mentioned. So, but okay, that's fair. That's fair. Okay.
Once I see the locked door, I don't glean that as good, because you don't need to lock a door for any good reason I could think of in this situation. And I am rash and I am reckless. So I land on that professor's head as an octopus, wrap him completely up as much as I can, and then with one of my other tentacles go to unlock the door. But I am just like trying to
slam.
So wait,
are you going for the
guy.
Professor or for Sir Reginald Kensington,
yeah,
the movie star?
I think
who
you
locked
up
the door?
Kensington did.
Kensington did.
Then that dude is gonna get a face full of octopus.
Hope you like your calamari. Okay.
He gets to roll to oppose your effect.
Oh yeah,
let's
absolutely.
Let's see if he can beat 1 million.
Oh, I was ready to roll. Okay, no, that makes sense.
Rolled a 3, so he gets a face full of octopus. You have him fully grappled, so much so that his mouth is actually completely covered. He can't make a sound.
So
and
it's
you reach...
like my face is his face? Like he has like an octopus head right now?
Sure. There's nice. Also now a raven and a papusa in the room, because there's no way you could have possibly...
Oh, no, I would have had to drop those. So the badger and stuff, that's life, you know?
Yep. Yep. So you get that million roll. That's... Oh, right. It's a 4. So, yes, he rolled a 4 because Naveen's force
oh,
of a 4.
Perfect,
so,
yeah.
There you go.
There you go.
Sorry. All right.
I
so,
love it.
Good.
He is getting eaten by an octopus right now, and the octopus reached down.
I'm just preventing him from breathing and talking.
Okay.
Oh my
there
God.
Is now a raven and a papusa, and Quilliam sees this as he is not engaged with anybody.
I glare at him with my octopus eyes.
Okay. He takes... Let's see, how smart is he? He's not smart. He's the product of nepotism. All right, so he reaches
fire
over.
Ball,
he takes a book.
Fireball.
He takes a book and he chucks it at you, which is also the face of Sir Reginald Kensington.
Perfect.
I'm going to try.
He rolls
sorry,
a 9 to throw it at you.
Ooh, that's a good one.
So you can roll your flight to escape the...
Okie dokie. Base 12. Flight is the one thing. Flight is the D12. So 12?
Okay, yep.
It's
yep,
just natural, right? There's nothing else to it.
Mm-hmm. So now do you get out of the way, or do you actually yank Kensington out of the way with you?
I mean, if you're giving me narrative control, then I've got his arms, and I like smack the book out of the way.
That would be a brawn roll. That would be a brawn roll, a fight roll rather than a flight roll.
Oh, then yeah, in which case I like kind of grab, use his hand to grab the doorknob and just pull myself forward and move out of the way.
Okay, so you are puppeting him. Got it. Understood for the scenario that we're in.
I mean, I got a million, so yes.
Yes, you are puppeting. Okay.
I mean, only his upper area. I probably couldn't get to his lower.
Okay. What do you do?
Barnabas? I feel like in this...
Barnabas has an action, I'm sure.
Yeah, that's why I'm like, Barnabas hasn't done anything. And
yeah,
like,
what are you doing?
Well, Barnabas, who's like sort of taking in the fact that like the door got locked and then Kensington got covered by an octopus. Quilliam Jr. threw a book at him. Is sort of like assessing what the professor's doing, because that's who his dialogue has been. So seeing if she's like starting to lose a little bit more focus on the situation or what.
Mm-hmm. She is, yes, by the fact that Kensington is being eaten by an octopus, and there's now a raven squawking and flying through, and a pupusa has fallen to the ground and is rolling into a cute ball, because I assume, I don't know what pupusas do.
Oh, it's like the little, it's just like a little cloth thing you carry things on, so imagine like baby carrier, but for a...
No, what's the thing inside of it, the badger?
A badger.
Okay, so yeah, the badger has rolled up in a cute little ball inside of it, I guess, because I don't know what badgers do.
Okay. Thank you. Then Barnabas is going to pull out his wand and say to Quilliam Jr., the professor's gone mad! She sicked her octopus on Kensington! Watch out! And he's going to try and charm Quilliam Jr. to now see Professor Cosgrove as an enemy, pretty much like his greatest fear.
Oh, you're casting a spell.
Yeah.
Yep.
Also, you can't lie, remember.
Oh, you're right.
Thank you, Naveen.
Touche. So I won't say that. I will say...
Attack the goddamn...
I'll say, Professor Cosgrove's up to no good, Quilliam. Do something about it, and I'll charm him.
Okay.
He doesn't know if that's what.
That's true.
Definitely feels like the truth at that point. Anyway.
Yeah, the door got locked. She's looking at people. She freaking truth spelled me.
Okay. Make me your roll. This is... Jeez. So, unnatural, so plus three. A person, so plus three. Mm-hmm. How long do you want this to last?
I'd like it to last for, I don't know, like 5 minutes.
Okay, so plus one, so that's seven. And how many times have you charmed people like that?
In your pudding.
Doesn't matter anymore, George.
No, it doesn't.
You have to make that more expensive, buddy.
I think I have charmed people before, right?
So you cast it.
I've cast it.
Brings it to an eight.
Oh.
And this is a charm, right? This is definitely a charm.
Yes, but the seven is your total.
Oh, not even with my positives?
Nope.
This is a nightmare. Walrus, why? All right, well.
So, Quilliam turns to you, and she's like,
I know.
Oh, well, that's a problem.
Okay, George, I am flinging this door open.
Okay.
Now that it's unlocked.
Okay. So you're running to the door and flinging it open?
Yeah, I mean, I'm pretty close.
Yeah. Give me your flight.
Okay. All right. D10. Where's my D10? Right here. That's a five.
Okay.
Yes, dice system!
Okay, you make your way to the door and you manage to open it. You do not have enough power within your flight to make it through, but you have opened the door.
Oh, that's fine. How does this work? Can I try my spell again, too?
Sure.
Okay. Here we go.
No problem. The fate of the game depends on this, but we believe.
Yeah.
Yeah,
I'm waiting for that loaded die to pop in right now.
No, please, everyone, please.
Just roll
unless
quickly.
It's really good.
What are you
good.
Doing? Roll.
Okay,
stop.
I rolled already.
That was a good one, right?
That's a 24.
Oh, my God. Okay. A 24. Yes, there is a huge blinding flash. So let's get you guys who did not know that this was coming to make your resistance rolls.
What am I?
Are we averting our eyes?
What was the roll you made?
So
I wasn't. I didn't know this was happening.
I should say that my follow up once things happen, my follow up is to like pull them and run.
Okay.
We don't know that. So
oh, that's fine. That's fair. I'm just throwing that out there.
So, what did you actually roll? That was brain. Was it brains or Amelia?
That was brains. Yeah.
Great. So you guys make your brains roll to oppose her 24.
Yes. Yes.
4 + 3, 7.
Nice and easy. That 2, baby. I think that beats 24.
Okay.
Why?
So Desmond and Barnabas, it sinks into your eyes. You are blinded by this light, as is Quilliam and Professor Cosgrove. However, Sir Reginald Kensington has an octopus on his face and cannot be affected by a burst of light.
Cool.
Oh, I missed the glitter now! I think my retinas are gone!
Oh, wait! Good point, Walrus. Shared pain. As Amelia, the blindness hits you as well.
Ah, this is agony! Professor, why are you doing this?
Well, so here's my question.
Uh-huh.
Because I knew it was coming anyway.
Mm-hmm.
And because I knew my own plan. Mm-hmm. Can't I reasonably, like...
steal yourself?
Either steal myself or, like, grab at them and try to... You know what I mean?
You could still reasonably try, at least for the octopus, but Barnabas is further away from the door because he's over by the desk.
You're probably going to have at least one of us die.
But you knew where you were. You knew your plan. You knew that you were probably going to get hit by the shared curse.
Yeah. You know what? It might be better if I grab Barnabas. I feel like I trust Desmond more to just...
That one will, of course, be the harder one, as you need to make your way to the desk, grab him, and then get back to the doorway.
But you probably memorized stuff knowing you were going to get blinded.
That's why it's... Yep, you're going to get the brains roll.
Okay. All right, I will try for Barnabas and see where things go.
Okay. So you're going to attempt to make your way to Barnabas, grab him, and lead him out the door.
Yeah.
I am trying to inspect.
Question, George. Am I gaining adversity tokens after each one of these fails?
Yes, every time you fail a roll, you get an adversity token.
Oh.
I got a lot of adversity tokens.
I only have 2.
Yeah, well, there haven't been that many failures. Well, actually, Amelia had quite a run.
We start with 3 at the beginning of the game, right?
Forgot about that.
Yep.
We start with 3 at the beginning and you fail. But I gain 2 for each failure. So I'm looking bad, but I'm feeling real good.
Mm-hmm. If we were not in snap decision territory, you could help Amelia out a lot right now.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. So, Amelia, let's get that brains roll to try to navigate to Barnabas, grab him, and drag him out of this room. So I'm going to need a brains roll to try to make your way to him and then back, and a flight roll to do it without, you know, anything catching you.
I'm just adding my... Okay, so I got an 11...
Okay. With the 11, you've been in this office enough times and for long enough right now to make your way to Barnabas and grab him and start making your way back. I now need your flight roll to do it to safely escape from this situation.
Yeah, we all know how well I do with that, so.
Ah, this blindness is the worst pain in the world. Who would do that? Wow!
Okay. All right, so I got a 9 and I'm considering adding adversity tokens.
If you get a 10, you would definitely probably be safe.
All right, so just add 1 then. I appreciate that.
Okay. Yeah, this is a system where the difficulty can be out in the open. It's not like I need to.
Oh, cool.
Yeah.
Cool.
Okay.
I'm going to try and infect my celebrity as like a brain parasite and just officially puppet him.
What?
What? I'm going to try and infect my guy as if I were a brain parasite and fully control him. So I'm doing like a controlled spell, but it's based on, it has caveats like I have to be touching him.
Okay.
So it's like a localized charm spell. I don't know if we get bonuses for making caveats like, so with his, with the one Barnabas tried to do, it was a charm, but was like, you know, whatever. But mine is like, I have to be like, you know, kind of seated where I am and everything like that, or touching him, or have a finger in an ear or something.
So no, but it affects things like magnitude and area of effect and duration, things like that. So,
all right,
so you want to make him a puppet.
Yeah. Oh, just
that is reality breaking.
Makes sense.
Yeah. It is persons, so that's small, so it's at 10. And how long do you want this to be? You want this to be a permanent effect that's going to be forever and ever?
No, well, I mean, forever and ever seems like, I mean, at this point, it's like, go big or go home. It's like, now you're on my team, guy. But no, that sounds weird. What, Desmond wouldn't think to do that.
Okay, so this how is... long do you want it to last?
I don't know, as long as I'm touching him.
You need a duration for the spell. We'll otherwise, it's permanent. Half hour, okay.
I really just need to be able to run with this guy who has eyes.
And have you turned into an octopus, then infected them with a brain parasite spell in order to try to guide them as you're walking?
I've done it to animals where I touch them and then I see through their eyes, like small animals, but I've never done it to people, no.
And have you ever seen somebody do this before?
No, this is probably very not allowed.
Okay, cool. So you are inexperienced with this.
Yeah, yeah. So I literally am pushing my nervous system partially into their nervous system, so it's probably big no-nos.
Why not?
So that's going to bring you to a 15 difficulty on this charm roll. And this is, yes, almost definitely illegal, Megiddo.
I got a... Can I add adversity?
Yes, you can. You can spend adversity.
Then I got a 15 because I got a 13 base.
Okay. You get your 15. Jeez. With that is a zero success. You cast the spell, but just barely. The strain is clear for everyone watching, and the spell might not function perfectly, but it gets the job done.
He's just going to walk into some walls and stuff.
So basically, you're going to be at a minus one for any navigation things that you need to do.
100% totally cool. But yeah, I lift my octopus self like over to the side so that way I can see through one of his eyes. And then I don't, obviously I'm not controlling him super well. Also, I don't have an adult body, so like I'm running and I'm like, like as like I run down the hallway.
So as you begin to infect and corrupt his brain, you also feel something else burning at you.
Ah. But I'm in his nervous system. It's left. It's less of a... It's more like Ambula Amlangata. I'm not trying to get into his brain bits. But that's fine.
Yeah.
It's burning at me.
Yeah. Okay.
What's burning?
What's burning?
What does it feel like? Yeah. Or is that it? I'm just like, yeah, this doesn't feel
It feels like a presence pushing against you. And its push is almost burning your senses as it comes into contact.
That makes sense. I'm sure people like him have protections and stuff.
I don't think that's what it is at all, but I, as Desmond, let me go to roll my brains. Nope.
Okay, and nobody can see it, but Reginald Kensington begins puppet dancing out of the office.
Good.
And meanwhile, Amelia, what did you roll on your flight roll? That was a long time ago. You got enough. Yeah, you got enough.
Enough because I spent an adversity token. Yeah, just enough.
And Amelia pulls the blinded Barnabas out into the hall.
It's like the blaze of 1,000 suns in my eyes.
As I'm going, I'm just like, let's just keep going.
Oh, is that you, Amelia? Oh, I'm saved.
As we're running out the door.
Okay. You all make your way out the door. The only one who can see is Desmond, and he is not in his own body.
Yeah, it's really weird looking like this. Actually, I'm going to say, because I know somebody's going to bring it up, I'm going to scoop up the two blinded familiars, and then I run. So now I'm running with stuff in my hands.
Okay. Stuff in your hands. You also had the two boxes from the bookshelf, I believe, right?
I get those would be inside of my Desmond person, which is an octopus.
Okay.
I assume things morph in and I'll have to like get naked.
Okay. Gotcha. Okay. So, you and
How do Amelia and Barnabas make their way down the halls at this point?
So at this point, I presume you got a hold of my robe.
I have your wrist. Like, okay, cool. I'm just going. Yeah.
I'll try. Well, are they gonna like?
Yeah, I mean, what part did you grab when you reached out blindly to?
Yeah. Grab. Yeah, sure. She's got me by the wrist. So while we're running,
and Amelia is still invisible. Face. Yes.
Barnabas is going to open his robe and go, Mr. Pebbles, on my head, now! And have Mr. Pebbles climb onto my shoulders and say, Mr. Pebbles, I can't see! You gotta get us back to Lambspew's living quarters! Nobody ever likes to go there! They couldn't possibly find us! Just direct me back to Lambspew! Tug on my left ear if I got a turn, or my right ear if I got a turn.
I'm gonna shout to Mr. Pebbles, go to the secret library instead, and monkey.
Of course, sir. Thank you for that guidance. Ooh. Far better than going to the Lambspew Hall.
All right, Mr. Pebbles, Lambspew away!
And you begin being ratatouille'd down the hall. Amelia, you can't see, but now Barnabas starts trying to lead you.
Don't worry, Amelia. Mr. Pebbles will get us to Lambspew.
Oh, no! And I allow it to happen, but I'm...
That's what everybody says about Lambspew. Lambspew for life!
As we run down the...
Okay, and you begin making your way down the hall. Give me your flight rolls, please, Barnabas and Desmond.
Sure, yeah.
I'm at minus one, because this guy is bad at running.
Ooh, and Naveen raise the stakes. Yes.
Naveen.
All right. Naveen, are you giving me free rein on what to do to them, or do you have any suggestions?
Naveen, please.
That's not a suggestion.
You know, it's usually a good sign. It's usually a good sign when somebody redeems something for a channel and then laughs.
You know, I'm just throwing this out there, everyone. We have one that helps us.
Yeah, now that's going to gain even more dust because we've mentioned it.
You got it, Naveen.
That's, you know.
I don't think they should get away from the tax teacher.
Come on. Oh,
that's
God.
Tax evasion.
Oh.
Oh, man, I wish I could give awards. Anyway, okay, so you begin. Did you guys roll your flights?
Yeah.
Yes, I got a 7.
And Desmond?
I actually feel worse for getting good rolls now. I got a 37.
What the fudge?
I got a natural 20, and then I rolled an 18. So it's like, I was about to be like, I got an 11, because I was like, this is a fucking ridiculous roll.
Okay, so you guys.
This guy was a track star, turns out.
There you go.
Oh, hey, thank you, Naveen. Okay, so you begin making your way down the hall, and you hear a piercing screech from behind you, and you see
Jabberwocky.
You see tearing out. Well, actually, you don't see. Who sees?
Oh, actually,
Mr. Pebbles
sees.
Definitely sees.
I feel like I'm pretty focused. What does the screech sound like? And I'll decide if I turn this guy's head or not.
What does the screech sound like? The screech sounds like a howl of death and horrific mourning and pure rage.
Yeah, you know what? It's not my eyes. I turn this guy's head. We'll look.
Okay. You turn your head and you see... tearing from the office, the form of Professor, name I've forgotten.
Cosgrove.
Linda Cosgrove, yeah.
Professor Cosgrove, as she tears her way out, and you can see her skin has begun to melt away as energy is piercing through it. Her face is deforming into this horrific mask of vengeful energy as she starts tearing down the hall at you. Her eyes have completely burned away and are replaced with shining spheres.
And everybody's just okay with this? Like, the janitor's just like, yeah, she does that on Tuesdays.
Well, it's class. You know, it's a class.
It's during class.
Yeah.
You guys are cutting class to do this.
All right. I mean, I'm just... This is quite a promotion.
There's still, well, they might come out in a while, but
I would hope so.
Also, with magic explosions and stuff, a lot of these rooms are probably soundproof.
Also, let's be fair. Let's look at all of the Harry Potter movies. How many times when they were being chased down the halls by something did anybody randomly stumble into them?
Nobody found that troll. You got
too many halls.
The troll, the snake.
Yeah, you gotta be kidding me.
Okay.
Cool.
How's that for up in the stakes?
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, that sure does.
Hi, guys. Not a panicky mind thing like that, but there's a deer chasing us.
There's a what?
Don't jump on him.
Okay. I'm going to need some new flight rolls from everybody, please.
Oh. And now I'm yelling about how my life is over. I'm going to get kicked out of the school. I'm going to die. Everything is over. Everything is terrible. Why did I do this? Why do I do these things?
It's my turn to explode dice twice.
You did it!
Oh. Okay.
Oh, wait. So who does that...
I'm taking it. It's mine.
Whoever was.
Thank you, Naveen.
Who does
Thank
that?
You.
All right, I guess
mine.
Okay,
That's
fine.
My flight.
I guess this is how this works.
Thanks, Naveen. I knew that you wanted that one to go to me, so thank
Clearly.
You.
Okay.
It's all Naveen's guilt.
Amelia and Desmond. What did you roll? Against your target
I got a
28.
I got a 5, but I
exploded
am being,
a 12 twice and then
I'm
rolled
being
a
led
4.
Now.
24 doesn't even do squat on that?
You have adversity.
Oh, yeah. Okay, yeah. Let's throw that in. Because I have a 24. I love this loaded dice game. I love it. I love it.
All right, Amelia, what did you get?
I got 5.
And Desmond?
I have a question. Because okay. I might not be running anyway. Does this guy have any forms that he turns into? Like,
no.
What does this guy change into? Nothing? He doesn't polymorph?
No, he was
what a nerd!
Yeah, he's an actor. He's not
a
sports
celebrity
person.
Celebrity from Mingling with the Mortals.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Would his... Could I force a polymorph into his body? And not have it come as one of my polymorphs.
So
essentially,
will
the strain is on
transform.
You, but now the strain's on you. So he'll be, instead of a guy with an octopus on his head, he'll be a rhino with an octopus on his head.
What? That's awful. Wow. That's a nightmare.
Why? He will.
Because I don't think you guys are going to get away.
Definitely get to resist that. But sure. Sure,
George. For these roles, you meet, you beat, or you have to exceed.
Meet, beat.
Okay.
Yeah.
I am spending 4 adversity tokens. Improve okay. myself to a 28.
All right.
Rich wants to push this world very far. Apparently.
Yeah.
There's a lady who's just gonna kill us for pranking her, and I'm the bad guy for riding
yeah, he's
on
right.
a guy. And...
Yeah.
Yeah.
He's right.
So
he's right. Yeah. This escalated. It's a one shot.
This is reality breaking. This is small, so that's 10. How long do you want this transformation to last?
It's the normal one, so it's normal whatever polymorph is. So I need to keep it in keeping with the world. So I want it to not last that long because it would be great. But an hour is the answer.
Well, you are. This is okay. An hour, fine. So that's 12, and this is you have. Morphed yourself before. Have you ever morphed somebody else?
God, no. This is way out of my fucking depth.
Okay, and you've never seen anybody do it?
No, because the thing, other thing is, I'm not just transforming him, I'm transforming him as if I was transforming, which is this is a very different ballgame.
Okay, so that brings you to a 16 of difficulty.
Okey dokey. I have actually changed my mind. I'm going to change him into a cheetah, and I'm going to be an octopus riding on a cheetah.
That's fine. It doesn't change the difficulty.
Sure. Yeah, why not?
All right, cheetokey. It doesn't change the difficulty, but it changes what I roll on the difficulty.
That is true. You get to roll your flight instead of fight.
And it's a polymorph-based skill, which gives me a little bit extra. So that's not, it's not going to be enough. But yeah.
What did you get?
I got a 17 plus. I threw the dice away. 17 plus 2.
Okay. So you succeed, but not impressively. Although the very act of casting that spell is impressive.
Yeah,
so
this is like historical. That you just forced polymorphing onto another person.
So we've now got a cheetah with an octopus running away. We've got Barnabas somehow hightailing it faster than anybody could expect, and dragging Amelia along with him. So Amelia, because he is going so very fast, you can attempt your flight roll again to not get left behind.
If this makes sense, I would say at this point, do we have all of our belongings?
Megiddo, the creative can be, as long as it's something that fits with the world, you can be very creative.
We have all of our belongings, right?
Yes. Yes. The stuff that's in your knapsack, you are assumed to always have on your person.
Including my broom?
What's your... Yes, including your broom.
Ooh. Oh, dip! So we have brooms!
We had brooms.
So I would say that with that ridiculous flight roll, Barnabas squeaks his broom out of his pack, which is sort of like diagonally stowed in there, and hops on it now, sort of dragging Amelia and going, come on! It's kind of like doing like the back to the
future. Oh my god.
Like when he's trying to grab trucks on his like skateboard kind of scene.
So... with that in mind, how do you get guided by your monkey flying?
That's a great question, George. I assume in a very panicked fashion. He's still pulling. It's just whether or not I go splat or not.
Okay.
Can I... okay, let me think here. Can I try to cast something to relieve his blindness?
Yes, you could try to cure his blindness.
Sure. Okay.
Let's now, chat, while she's doing that, will the shared pain, if she cures his blindness, will it cure her blindness?
Did it come from him?
It's true.
Leave it to the chat to decide.
Yep.
Naveen brutal says yes. And kind says yes.
Naveen, the one who gives and takes.
Okay, so you are attempting to cure his blindness, which is more just helping his eyes to recover from the brightness. So that is a natural thing, but
go ahead.
Yep. The lack of pain is still pain. So. Oh, the difficulty is not going to be anywhere near that. So, yes, you are able to cure his blindness.
Oh, that feels all bad. Wow! Turns real sharply before we splinter into a wall.
Okay. You see the demon creature on the ground chasing. Yeah. There's a...
This is so ridiculous.
Okay. I'm going to need a new flight roll from Rich with his new form up against her new flight roll. Okay. And what did you get?
Do I get any bonuses for my cool new cheetah form?
You get a second roll is what you get.
Yes!
That's huge.
No, you got that second roll, the one that he's making right now.
I liked my old roll better than that. All right, then
no, you didn't. You failed that first roll.
I was going to fail anyway. I got that's a total of 7.
Total of 7?
Unless the polymorph, because he is polymorph, gives me the 3, in which case it's a 10. But either way, it's not. I'm not writing home about that roll.
Okay, and she rolled an 8.
Adversity tokens. Adversity tokens.
She doesn't
tokens.
Have adversity tokens to spend.
I just got one.
Ooh.
Can I spend tokens for him?
Nope, because this is the snap decision moment. You can only spend tokens for other people and a plan.
Okay.
Oh, you're a brute.
It's totally fine.
So, do you spend any adversity tokens?
I don't have any.
Oh, I thought you got one. Didn't you get one?
I meant I just got one, like, just now, because I failed. That was.
Didn't you get one when you failed the initial escape roll?
Oh, yeah. So then I have an 8. Does meat beat?
Meat beats.
Or meat matches. Meat. We're just cruising at the same speed.
Meat beats.
Meat beats.
All right, then I will do that.
There you go.
And you pull away from the horrific monster that at one point was your mortal economics teacher, or their mortal economics teacher, as you begin making your way to the secret meeting point.
We should probably not go there with this thing hot on our tail.
Well, now that I can see. To Lampspew! Away!
Yeah, I know.
I just keep trying to follow them from the ground.
Okay. And you make
your
way.
When you get close enough, do you, like, jump on to one of us, possibly?
I don't think that that's going to go good. It's okay. Kids on Broom's plural. It's not kid on broom. I don't think it would go so good.
Yeah.
So,
Okay.
Oh, fuck.
Fly us to Lampspew.
Yeah, I'm going to just keep on trying to follow, like, at this point. Like, that's all I can do.
The best quarters any kid could be in.
Okay. Sure, and you make your way to Lampspew. You get quite a few odd looks from the students that are in the halls now that it's between classes at the cheetah being ridden by an octopus, as well as a child flying on a broom dragging another child. But they do not look at the demon creature oddly because the demon creature has ceased following you.
Ugh.
Probably a good call.
Just practicing, just practicing, I say as we finally lock in. There you go.
Yes, at this point, the control, now that once you reach Lampspew, it's probably nearing the end of its control.
For 30 minutes. Hour?
Yeah.
I exert control permanently.
Stop it.
You can try that roll.
Stop it.
No, Desmond isn't a bad guy. Also, I don't think he's that clever, so.
Hey, it's not like we'd know. We'd be like, wow, this was a crazy experience. Also, you control him now? Crazy.
But
true, cheetahs are sprinters, which allowed to get away from the monster, and now it's more just keeping pace with the broom.
Oh, that's true. They're burst speed. They're not They're not long-time runners. That's a very good point.
I don't think Amelia's invisible anymore, however. I'm pretty sure that was a quick effect that you gave
That
her.
Was an hour.
That was an hour?
Jeez. Yeah. Okay, Amelia
is
still
invisible. I'm still
minutes, and you were like, 1 hour.
Amelia is still invisible, so they do not see the
guilt.
Child being dragged.
Question of note, though, George, am I still telling the truth?
Yes.
Okay.
So were you really heading to Lampspew?
Yes.
Going to Lampspew.
I try and wave you guys down with my octopus arms as we stop being chased.
I'll slow down once. I mean, if it's obvious that we're no longer being chased by a giant demonic, you know, or not giant, but demonic force of energy, I'll say, all right, we can stop. We can walk to the Lampspew now. We can just walk, and I'll land my Valiant's 2400 broom and be like, Amelia, are you still here?
I thought today was going to go so much different than it actually went. I can't believe it. Just what
can you make,
what did
can,
you turn into it?
Can you make us see you? I can't see you. It's very confusing just talking to nothing.
I can't say anything. I'm an octopus. But I do turn this cheetah into a rat.
You can attempt it.
That is what I'm going. Yeah, that's when I say I'm going to. I mean, I'm going
okay.
to try.
So this is again reality break. What was it before? It was a 15 before, but now you've done it once, so it's gonna go down to a 13 to do.
I got a total of 17.
Okay, you turn him into a rat.
Nice.
And I'm 30 gonna minutes. Roll to undo my invisibility.
Yeah, I turn back into me at this point. I'm just holding the rat.
Okay.
So I've probably also the parasite thing would wear off when I'm out of the octopus form.
Sure. Okay. So you now hold a squirming rat in your hand.
I look at it angrily and say, "Don't make me grow gorilla hands."
Give me a charm roll.
You got it.
No,
I'm not lying.
No. Hang on. That's not charm. That is definitely. Ooh. What do you think?
Feels
fight.
Like charm.
I mean,
it's less threatening people in this world. It's
sure,
up to you. Charm is definitely being like, haha,
Like, sure. It could be grit. It could be...
Roll that fight. Charm.
Yeah.
All right. Then I got a 7.
Oh, he got an 8, but okay. You don't know.
I don't know if he thinks
that's true. He's just a rat.
He just... Yeah. The little rat stares up at you.
All right. So I look at everybody else and I say, we got to go to the headmaster now.
I got an 8 to make myself not invisible.
I got a 20 to make you invisible, so you were invisible.
Yeah. Sorry. You're still invisible, okay. I guess.
Amelia, come on. Now's not the time to fool around.
I can't. I'm not fool.
Oh, I changed the pigment filtration systems on your skin. It's not like a normal invisibility spell. I used one that messes with your biochemistry.
I know how things work. I'm just...
No, but I did it different than you're used to.
Then why don't you undo it?
That's a good point.
We gotta go to the headmaster, and I say, shaking the rat.
What's with the rat?
Fine. Let's just go. I'll just be invisible, and I'm just gonna, like, grab onto both of them as we walk.
Oh!
I'm doing a hurried walk. I say, this is the... What's that guy's name? Because he's a celebrity, so I should know.
Sir Reginald Kensington.
I say, this is Sir Reginald Kensington.
From Mingling with the Mortals?
Yes.
Oh, right. He was in the room, wasn't he?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Why don't we, like, put him in, like, a bubble that he can't break out of? Because he's, like, just a little rat now.
I don't know. Then put him in a bubble. I don't know how to make bubbles.
I'm going to try and put him in a bubble.
But what if you can't breathe in the bubble?
That's true, but
we're not thinking this through.
All right, I'll put a hole in the bubble. A tiny hole in the bubble.
What?
And I put him in a bubble.
Oh.
I have a literal jar we could put him in right now, but I'm not going to do that because it's much better.
Yeah. I'm putting him in a bubble with one hole in it.
Okay. Try and make that bubble. This is... How long do you want this bubble to last?
For half an hour.
Okay. Unnatural.
Stuck around my hand.
And bending the rules of reality, because you're making a bubble that's not going to pop, but also has a hole in it.
Yeah, it's got like one little spot, you know?
Size of a book, sure. So it's a 6. You said half hour, so 7. And have you made a bubble with a hole in it before?
No. No.
And have you seen anybody make a bubble with a hole in it before?
I've probably seen people create, like, containers or, like, you know, protective fields or things like that before, but I've never done anything like this.
Okay, so you're looking for a 12.
Okay, what am I throwing at this?
Let's see. This is going to be a test of strength because you're attempting to grapple him within this, so it's going to be brawn.
Okay.
Makes sense.
I rolled a 10, and you said it's a 12, so I'm going to spend 2 adversity tokens, because I am flush, and I make a bubble with a hole in it.
Okay, you make a bubble with a hole in it.
Little hamster bubble. Now he's in that.
Okay. The gorilla hand threat now rings a little more hollow.
Now you're stuck in a bubble, you stupid rat, but I love your show.
By the way.
So, let's do this. Great. Okay, and... Okay.
All right, so we're going to go to the headmaster? Is that what we're thinking?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. Because, I mean, clearly the professor's gone crazy, and Quilliam's a jerk, and Kensington, I mean, he was locking the door on me, wasn't he? So yeah, we got. Let's tell the headmaster.
But are we really gonna be believed?
I mean, I can't tell a lie right now. I think so. It would make sense that they would believe me.
Why would we go to them in this situation? We're definitely in trouble.
Yeah, I'm not gonna lie. Just speaking as a 14-year-old boy, I think I'm in way over my head already. I mean, it's been maybe 10 minutes of our. Of our actual existence in this one shot, but this is going crazy fast. I really do think that we should probably talk to the headmaster.
Okay.
Unless, Amelia, is there something you can find out about the key? I mean, you got a key, right?
I do have a key. I'm going to look at the key.
You have a tiny little key.
We can hold it up to your eyes and attempt to examine it.
You can give me a brains roll. And Desmond has the two boxes.
It's an 8.
Okay, it looks like a very, very, very small key. There's not much discerning. There's not much to tell about it, aside from the fact that it appears very old. But it's hard to get much more detail while it is tiny. The rat, meanwhile, is looking at each of you, its nose twitching.
It's a nerd.
And then it vanishes.
The rat?
Yes.
As in just disappears.
Yes. Remember, you don't need your wand to work magic.
Is there anything in there?
Not you don't feel anything, Thunk. And so he changed. He didn't change into the creature. He changed into the octopus earlier, and everything merged into him when he did the polymorph. And then later he transformed the other guy into a chia.
Yeah. It's like, what is it called? Hammer space? You know, the concept that...
So, yes, it was like in his pockets when he transformed, so all of his clothes...
It's like a vector trap. Also, it's just how polymorph works.
We don't need them to lose either all their clothing and items every time they polymorph.
We are children people.
That's all in his pockets of his clothing. Yep.
Dez, block the breathing hole. If he's still in there, we'll just suffocate him.
No!
But then he'll pass out! You're doing it, buddy!
No, let's just keep going. Let's please keep going.
Yeah, we'll keep going, but definitely hold on to that little
hole. Don't do that!
Come on, Amelia! Start guiding her.
I'm like shaking the thing around more. Like,
we're kids, you know? We make mistakes. Whatever.
Are our familiars still blind?
Yes.
My rat was under my monkey was underneath my
monkey is fine, but the raven and the badger are still blind.
Mm-hmm.
So I can't be like, go find a rat, because that would probably be something a badger would be good at, but he's blind as fudge.
It's also something a raven might be good at, but again, blind. And Mr. Pebbles is Mr. Pebbles.
He's got hands. I mean, that's the benefit of monkeys.
He's got little monkey hands.
Psychos. Yep.
No, we're not. We almost got murdered, all right? When someone tries to kill you, you kill them right back.
Sorry, Megiddo. Craig killed you. I'm sorry to hear that.
Yeah. You're welcome, buddy. but we do continue heading to the headmaster's while we're trying to suffocate what we can believe to be Kensington still in the bubble.
Okay.
But we're making our way there.
All right. You make your way to the headmaster's office.
Oh, thank you for coming to my office. I regret that I am not present and able to assist you at this time. I am off doing some artifact gathering for my next working. I will touch base with you upon my return.
Okay, that's a problem. What if we just send him like a magic message? We can tell him dire circumstances. One of your professors has become a demon and was trying to kill us.
We should just go to, maybe we should go to someone else. I have no idea what to do.
What's in these boxes?
I say,
jingling my pockets.
What do you mean boxes?
The boxes we found. What's in the boxes? Now it's time to explore the things we have.
Shouldn't we go somewhere else to... Should we go? Where are we supposed to go?
Why would we be here? Why would we be here? This is a pretty good place to be.
I mean, okay. at this point, we definitely can't get caught. It's a professor against us, right?
I don't know. What are those boxes?
That's a good question. Hey, can I see the bubble?
Yeah, sure.
And I take it, and I stick my wand into it, and I try to dispel any magic that's inside of it.
Okay, you.
you stupid invisible rat. All right,
so that's natural because you are exerting natural force upon things that should be magical. Tiny, small, instantaneous. So we're at up one so far, and you've probably done dispel before.
Yeah, definitely.
So your difficulty is two on this brains roll.
Well, I rolled a two.
Okay.
Nice.
You attempt to dispel within it, and nothing appears to occur.
Bummer.
All right, I think he's gone. Either that or we killed him. And I just throw the bubble over my shoulder.
And it, of course, makes that comical glass crashing sound that happens whenever you throw something over your shoulder.
Right, of course. But yeah, what's in the boxes?
I'm going to cast message. Like a group message thing.
To who?
To all of the Shifting Hunt players.
On our team?
Yeah.
Okay. Reality bending, because you can talk to people. This is bigger than a classroom, because you're trying to affect everybody that is on your team, which is it's the entire thing. This is an instantaneous effect, I assume? You're just going to say something
and
it's over?
Yeah, and it would be like school-wide. Like, would be the size.
So yeah, not yeah, like yeah. Worldwide, yeah. Oh, yeah. If it's bigger than a classroom, it's massive size.
Got it.
And have you done this before?
Oh, yeah.
Is this something you've mastered or something you've cast?
I haven't mastered anything but polymorph. We've established that. Not very
okay, so you are a difficulty 15 on this brains roll.
And it's a brains roll. This could not be better.
Great.
Have you done this before? Not successfully, probably. Nope. Three.
Oh, no. Three. That is a failure by a good amount. So, ooh. Spell fails in a dangerous burst of magic. Oh. Oh. Oh, good time for a raise the stakes. Yes.
We were just trying to send a magic text message. Yes. That's not even...
I feel like it shouldn't be that hard, and yet...
Oh, and he gave an idea. One of the boxes starts ticking. Okay. So, you enact your spell. You feel the message go out, but you don't feel like it reached your people. What was your message?
My message was going to be to meet up like at the field, but yeah, not... Okay. If it's any go past the hallway, it's probably nothing.
Oh, no. You feel the energy go out.
I don't feel like it goes far.
But the energy is not going to go to the right people, but it does go. Anyway, you then hear one of the two boxes begins to tick. Oh, and Magito's making things go easy. Oh, no, that's the first thing. That's the first time it's on
the team.
There's a friend out there. Oh, God, yes.
All right, Magito, what's your go easy on him?
You're the hero that we need.
Man, everyone
right now,
is so brutal.
We need you right now so badly.
Or are you leaving it up to me, Magito? You got an idea?
I only summoned the baby. That's true. Rose did a good job.
Yep. I'm just making sure I didn't miss any baby summons, did I? No. Okay.
I don't think so.
Okay, well, first of all, I didn't waste it at all.
He's right.
What if
He's
the
right,
message
though.
Crossed over into the veil and contacts one of the friendly spirits that don't get summoned by manifestation will join them on wacky adventures to help them against the bad spirits?
Sounds perfect, honestly. Okay. Makes perfect sense.
All right.
I love... It's so detailed.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
I love it.
That makes sense. So, the box begins ticking. What do you do?
We probably need to deal with that, right? But ticking isn't usually a good thing.
Is there a keyhole on it?
Is there a keyhole on it?
George?
Is there a keyhole on it? No.
I open that bitch up.
Okay. You open that
I'm
bitch
reckless.
Up. What it is, you open it up, and you see what appears to be... Oh, what are those fancy clocks with, like, the interconnecting circles, like an astrolabe or something like that. Whatever. It's a big fancy clock with lots of interconnecting circles that appears to not just be measuring time, but also passage, you know, days, and something that you're not sure of. There are sections of it that don't seem to correspond to time, but rather crossings. And that is ticking.
Uh-oh.
What do you do?
I'm gonna roll a brains.
Oh, sure. Okay.
Nope. Okay, Desmond doesn't say what I'm thinking. Wow.
And do you open box number two as well or no?
Stupid tchotchke, right?
Yeah, I opened the other box. What's the other box got in it?
Inside the other box is a folded piece of
paper. I hand you guys the clock thing. What is it?
A folded piece of old, old, old paper. You open it up, and it appears to be a map.
All right, so where?
You don't know. You don't recognize any of the landmarks currently. You can make a brains roll to see if that's incorrect, but you probably do not.
You know who might recognize them?
Mr. Pebbles?
I look at Amelia. The immortal caterpillars.
Oh, you're right.
Oh, not the caterpillars again.
Okay. You also can't look at Amelia because she's invisible. Yeah.
Oh, that's true. I look at an empty space where Amelia may or may not be.
I'm like, okay. Also, I'm gonna roll on this little doohickey.
Mm-hmm.
Brains, let's see, that's a 9.
Okay. You're not sure what they represent, but they all seem to be ticking toward some kind of overlap.
Maybe there's some sort of veil or something like that.
Meanwhile, you see, out of the corner of your eye, a sort of shimmer in the air.
I think she's back! I pull out my wand, and
I actually say to you guys, no, she turned into a big demon thing. It was pretty crazy.
Meanwhile, I'm just like, I don't want to die! I don't want to die! I don't want to die!
I just get ready to... I actually stand in front of them, and I'm just ready to turn into something at whatever this is.
And you hear a voice whisper from the shifting energy.
Don't worry. You got friends here. We're gonna see you through this. It's gonna be hard. We'll get you there.
Run! And I turn and I start running.
Can I try and snatch his collar?
And I guess, given that it is 11:22, that's where we're going to end this.
Good place!
That's a great place.
Oh my goodness.
Well, that was effing wonderful.
So the people who predicted that we were not going to finish in one night were, of course, correct, because, oh my gosh, how long in that office?
It's not our fault.
You gave us a clue!
I did. I made up clues because you guys kept looking at other things, and you just made it more and more complicated by the stuff you did.
Well, if you didn't make the little holes in bookshelves so entertaining.
Yeah.
That was originally just a knot in the back of it that was nothing inside of it, but then you invested so much effort into it, it had to be something.
Well,
and Walrus, I appreciate that. I'm envious.
That's a big deal for him.
I mean, honestly, it's a big deal for anybody. That just came out. So
yes.
I mean, the willpower.
Hell yeah.
Aww, thank you, Naveen, for the cheer.
Naveen, I gotta say, that the chaos you brought tonight...
Brutal. Mm-hmm. Right. And unexpected.
Everybody brought tonight.
Everybody did so much.
Oh.
Jesus.
I think we're gonna do quite well in this world.
It's gonna be okay.
So I guess we're gonna need to have a follow-up to this, assuming the chat is interested in such.
Yeah, that's true.
What did you guys think of this system?
I loved it.
I love it.
Yeah. It gives enough like space for creativity in terms
that.
Of all sorts of odds and ends, but it still has enough of a structure
mm-hmm.
that you're not just like struggling for like how you can accomplish rules. It's got just enough of flexibility with its process that you can really branch out and go in weird directions, but still feel like you're not like
going off the beaten path in terms of like a system.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I would definitely just mirror that, where I liked Kids on Bikes because it had a lot of the creativity, but obviously you're limited just within like what you can do. With this, it feels like there's just a lot more extra because obviously you added in the magical element, which just opens up, just as we've seen, just an infinite mm-hmm. amount of doors.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Any thoughts on the system before we go into some final plugs?
Everyone should play it.
I would good definitely stuff. Say that if you're more for a story oriented world,
yeah,
that this mm-hmm. is that this is definitely it. If you're and again, as someone who enjoys both Kick the Door In style and more of like the narrative, I think that this is such a heavy narrative type of game that if you enjoy that just about other games, it might not necessarily be. I would hugely recommend giving this game a try.
And I think especially in, you know, the situation we're in right now, where most games are done over Zoom or whatever, I think this kind of system lends itself so well to doing virtual D&D. So it's especially a fabulous system for people to check out right now, because like you said, Rich, it's so good for just storytelling and being part of a collaborative story. And I mean I love that too. That's more my bread and butter. So
also, Naveen, don't you dare go easy on us next time. At this point, I expect it. Like, you gotta
she
really
didn't go easy this time.
I know, but she's like, next time, no hardships. And it's like, Naveen, at this point, you have to, New Mama has to, like, draw, like, you as, like, a goddess holding, like, a scale with, like, wheel and well.
I have so many drawing ideas after this.
That's great. All right. Any other last thoughts? Okay. Then what have you guys got going on that you'd like to plug before we skedaddle out of here?
Oh, I have on Saturday round 2 of my Drunk of the Wild stream.
Ooh,
because nice. We managed to raise over $1,000 for Extra Life for the charity. So I promised my viewers, I was like, all right, this is what you get. So Saturday at 8:30, that's like my special stream this week. Cosplay, drinking game, and Zelda. Doesn't get any better than that.
Nice.
For me, Sunday, due to demand of one of my viewers, I'm going to be doing a Magic the Gathering Arena draft mm-hmm. session. I have a little stockpile of gold, and he has contributed his account to me for about 3 goes worth of arena drafts as well. So I'm only going to be doing drafts and wasting his money and mine. So if you're interested in seeing how I do, because I like to gamble in funny money and nothing says gambling like arena drafts,
yeah.
Feel free to queue in on that. That's twitch.tv/doandiegaming for at 2 p.m. Eastern Standard Time.
Nice.
All right. Rich, anything? Very cool.
I'm part of a really cool podcast called RPG Blender. You should check that out on Spotify and YouTube if you want to see. If you thought tonight and the kind of faces and things like that that George were making were something, you can feel those faces through audio.
Really can.
And in some cases, see them.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Those are also up on the YouTube.
If anything, listen to the Paranoia Run because, oh my God. So
and
good.
The shadow over the
shadow of the demon lord.
Oh yeah.
Shadow of the demon lord. I'm sort of channeling a little bit of Phineas in this.
You are actually. I was just thinking that.
Yeah. So.
See, I was getting vibes from something that's going to be releasing in our RPG future, starting in December. I believe we'll be reaching the next segment of our campaign, and I believe there's a character which was pretty well channeled by Barnabas during this.
Oh, you know what? Yeah.
I don't know if that was purposeful or not.
I don't remember what character we're referring to now.
Greg's character.
Oh, yeah, I guess I can see it. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
but that
bit.
Was not purposeful. That was not.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Not
yeah, you just like monkeys. Everybody loves monkeys. That's the real problem. So there's too many.
Yeah, my problem is
monkeys.
He got to the monkey before me. That's the problem. That I would have had a monkey if I thought to have a monkey.
All right. As for my own channel. Obviously, we're going to be doing this again, I hope, in the near-ish future. I am also going to be expanding in some other directions. I'm currently working on some
mechanisms to do Twitch Plays RPG games, where you guys will be able to control these characters jointly like you would on a Twitch Plays Pokemon style thing. So once that goes live, I hope you guys will be interested in joining that. And if you are, you can join the Discord where you'll be knowing, you know, being made aware when things go live and able to participate in them easier. So yeah, we've got that. I've got some ideas on how to do that. So in the near future, hopefully, you'll be able to join in on some of these RPG experiences. At the very least, I'm also probably going to be doing some homebrewing streams. And part of that will be having viewers come in at the end to playtest the stuff. Either being adventures that are encounters that you go through, homebrew monsters, whatever it might be. So if you're interested in participating in that, click the link in the Discord to follow us and make sure you know when that's going to be happening. Okay. Then I guess we should see, is there anybody we should raid to close out the evening?
Oh, sure, the answer is yes.
Don't really have anyone right now.
Ooh. Okay. I certainly don't. Anybody in the chat it's got like anything lipstick to recommend?
Who's hardcore Thursday night 11:30 streamers? That's who we are.
Anybody want to quickly jump on their own stream and I'll pass the raid over to you guys?
Hang on. I mean, I do have a couple people.
Okay.
Rocks in my dryer. He's delightful. He's playing Amnesia.
Okay. All right. Want to send me his name so I can get that in there?
Yes. He's very delightful. Wait, how do I? I just want to message you. I'll just put it in the chat here.
That works. Oh, and as I open up the chat, I see the message from Barnabas William Peck to me privately. I got a pee. Got it.
I did. I really had to pee. I had to pee so bad. I just wanted you to know.
I did not do that right. Nope. Good. What do I need to do? Slash? What's the?
Oh, slash.
Slash.
Yeah.
That's what I got wrong.
Forward slash.
Curse me and my.
It's all right. Look at this amazing overlay you have. I mean.
Yeah, seriously.
You're doing some pretty cool stuff.
Good night, everybody. Thanks for playing.
Yeah.
All right. Yeah. Thank you all for coming out. And I hope we will see you again in the near future for more RPG action. And until next time, thank you again, and remember, there's gaming outside the Forgotten Realms.